Well, hey everybody, I'm Colorful Arty, and it's finally here. This is my 1,000 subscriber milestone video. So first, I guess I should start by saying thank you very, very much to everybody who has subscribed to my channel. It's very humbling and really just awesome that 1,000 people throughout my time on YouTube have looked at my channel and been like, you know, I like this guy, and pushed the subscribe button. So I truly am thankful to all of you. I'm not gonna gush over it for super long because I'm sure you don't want the entire video to just be that, and we got a lot to cover. So the reason why it's taken me so long to make this video is for one, I got to 1,000 subscribers quite a while ago, a few months ago, and I'm only just now making the video. For one, I wasn't really sure what kind of a video I wanted to make, because, well, you know me, I'm a Let's Player and a streamer, so I like playing video games, and I'm like, hey, maybe I'll play a really special video game, like, for my stream, but there's a couple problems with that. For one, if there's a game that I want to play, I just play it and stream it kind of right away. I don't want to, like, waste time waiting around for it. So, if it's a game that I want to play, I'm going to play it eventually anyways, and it doesn't really make it special to play it as my 1,000 subscriber milestone video special. And if it's a game that I normally wouldn't play, it's probably because I wouldn't enjoy playing it, and it won't make for a very fun video if I don't like playing it. The big problem, though, is that 1,000 people have subscribed to my channel, and I know for a fact that the 1,000 people all subscribe for different reasons. I'm sure some of the people who subscribe because they like my Lemmings content. Some people subscribe because they really like my backyard baseball streams. Maybe you subscribe just because I played Pikmin 3 one time and you really enjoyed that and just left a sub. So I wanted this video to really be a celebration of my channel and all of you, and something that pretty much everybody who subscribed would want to watch and enjoy. So I didn't want it to just be a game, because, I mean, if I were to say do like an Ocarina of Time randomizer stream as my special, well, I'm sure not all of you subscribed for that, and that wouldn't really be great for you guys to see. So instead I decided I was going to make my 1,000 sub video kind of an overview of my channel in general and my Let's Playing and streaming career. Career, as if I've made any money out of it, and really just look back on my channel and how I started out, where I've grown, and some of my favorite Let's Plays, and just kind of go through the Let's Plays I've done, the streams I've done, and give a quick overview of basically how I feel about them, and what stuff has really stuck out to me over time, how I've changed, and maybe we'll spend a little bit at the end going over what will lie ahead for the future. So I hope that you guys enjoy this channel retrospective of Colorful Arty. So for the first topic I wanted to cover was, why did I start Let's Playing in general? Well, honestly, just simple answer, it seemed fun. No, really, it just kind of amounts to that. It seemed like a fun thing to do. I've always loved video games growing up. I will probably always enjoy playing them as my life goes on. And well, I've always enjoyed that, and Let's Playing was something that I got introduced to when I was in my late teens, right around the time I was in late high school as like a junior or a senior. I think my first experience with encountering Let's Plays was I was playing Mega Man, the Mega Man games, and I'm like, I really like these games, but I'm really, really bad at them. I can't figure out how to beat these bosses. So I tried to find videos on YouTube of people who could, you know, beat the bosses without using the special weakness weapons for them, and I found this guy named Rome Mithril, who did perfect runs of the Mega Man boss battles, where not only did he do it without needing the special weapons, he also did it without taking any damage, and I kind of learned from him how to beat some of those bosses that was giving me trouble. I also learned, I'm like, wow, this guy makes some entertaining videos, I really enjoy these, and that was kind of my gateway to Let's Playing. There was also a guy named Round the Wheel who played Lemmings and also played custom Lemmings levels, and well, I have a lot more to say about Lemmings later on in the video, but let's just say I've always enjoyed it, and the fact that there were custom Lemmings levels out there that he was making was kind of mind-blowing, and he was a pretty cool guy. I enjoyed his videos as well, and eventually I also discovered people like Chugga Conroy, and I enjoyed it. I'm like, you know what, hey, this seems fun. I could try it out too, you know. Never know. I could give it a try, see if it's enjoyable. And yeah, it was. I really liked it kind of right from the beginning. It's always been fun Let's Playing for you guys. It's fun recording things and getting videos out, getting to interact with people, hear comments from people on the videos I make, and over time, it's actually helped me in my life. It's made me more outgoing and sociable. It's helped me improve my communication skills, believe it or not, because I sometimes forget how to talk while recording. That's always fun. And even as the years have gone on where I've kind of moved on and don't really watch the original people who I watched anymore, and I don't really watch a whole lot of Let's Plays anymore at all, I still enjoy actually doing it for myself, and the small community that I have has been great, honestly. I've really enjoyed getting to interact with people. Some of you guys I've even been able to play games with over streams or over different recordings, so that's always been fun. I've loved getting to meet people, and again, here we are. If you're wondering, oh, did I ever expect that I would reach 1,000 subscribers? Yes and no. Like, when I first started out, I'm like, yeah, this seems pretty easy. I bet I could get to 1,000 subscribers. I didn't think I would ever make it, like, to be a huge YouTuber by any means, but I figured 1,000 was at least a somewhat attainable goal. I didn't know how long it would take, but I actually did figure that I could get there. Eventually, it kind of flip-flopped where I'm like, man, it's harder to get subscribers than I thought, so maybe I won't. But the thing about getting subscribers is it has a snowball effect. The growing and getting those first few subscribers is always the hardest part by far. Just getting your channel noticed is the hardest part by far. But as you get more people who watch your content, your content becomes more known. It's a higher chance of it getting recommended to other people. More people share it, and yeah, I've noticed that as my subscribers have grown, like, getting to 500, going from 0 to 500 subscribers took way longer than going from 500 to 1,000. Like, out of my entire time playing, I think, like, 75% of the time, or 80% of it, was spent getting to 500 subscribers, and then, like, I got from 500 to 1,000 in, honestly, like, 2 years. As opposed to like the 4 or 5 years that it took in order to get to 500. So yeah, it's a snowball effect. The bigger you get, the easier it is for you to get even bigger. So if you're out there and you're thinking about starting Let's Plays as well, just know it's the beginning part is the hardest part to grow for sure. So I have more to say on that later. But yeah, that's kind of why I started Let's Playing. And I started Let's Playing, for those of you who don't know, in 2016. When I was a sophomore in college, and it was actually kind of the beginning of the year in 2016 that I'm just like, you know what? I thought about it for like a year now. I'm just going to bite the bullet and actually, I'm going to try to record myself. And if I'm stressed out by it or don't like it, worst case, I don't have to upload it. So, yeah, that's... I'll cover a bit more about my beginning of Let's Plays in a little bit, but there are some other things about my channel that I want to go over first. First up is my avatar and my name. So, Colorful Arty, obviously not my real name, but that's my internet persona. How my name came about was actually... Arty was the idea that I had for a 2D side-scrolling game, The Colorful World of Arty, where it would be like a 2D side-scrolling game where you play as an ink blot who kind of go, and like each level is like a famous painting. And obviously that never happened because that's ridiculously complicated to make and I'm not very good at making games. It was just a random idea I had when growing up, but I figured, yeah, this game's never actually gonna happen, but I can still keep Arty alive. And plus, Arty being an inkblot is really easy to draw. I'm not good at drawing art, but I can draw my avatar in Microsoft Paint. So that's how my name and avatar came about. And actually, for those of you who have been on my channel for a long time, you've probably noticed that my avatar used to look quite a bit different. See this right here? This was the original Colorful Arty avatar. And as you can see, there's a lot of similarities. Same shape, same color, but the big difference here is that I look a lot sadder than my current avatar is. And honestly, I mean, the original avatar probably fits what my default face is a lot better, where I do just kind of have this resting frown on my face as a default. And I figured over time, I'm like, you know what? I should cuten it up a bit, and I change it to the little smile. And part of the reason I did that was one of my goals for my channel was that my avatar being an inkblot was going to have a bunch of different colors and emotions where basically I could change my profile picture depending on how I felt in real life. And I had a bunch of different like versions of the avatar where the blue was just kind of the default. If I was feeling happy, I had like a green version of the avatar with a bigger smile. If I was like super happy, I had a yellow version of myself with like a huge smile. If I was like on vacation, I had my orange avatar. That one you've actually have seen before. If I was angry, then I had the red avatar who was angry. If I was sad, I had a darker blue avatar who was crying. Here's the thing though. I was planning on just changing my avatar on like a daily basis. Didn't work out that way. One, that takes a lot of constant effort of monitoring that. I wasn't super sure if I wanted to just constantly be broadcasting my mood to everybody on the internet. And also I learned that, YouTube takes a while to actually display the changes to your avatar. If you're lucky, YouTube is going to change your avatar within 24 hours, but oftentimes it can take several days for the actual mood changes to, for the profile picture changes to process. So I'm like, yeah, not really worth it. So I just kind of kept my default avatar and I use my other avatars sparingly. There are also a couple of Arty avatars that I've created, but I've never actually shown. So here, I'll show them now. Yeah, so part of the reason I never show these off is they were way too situational. There's like depressed Arty, and I'm a happy person. I don't have depression or anything like that, so there was no point in that. Or like sick Arty, have a strong immune system, haven't gotten sick since college. Or like scared Arty, yeah. Like none of these really ever saw the light of day. So, well, there you go. Another thing that has changed over time is how I name videos. So, back in the original days of my channel, and actually I kept doing this for some time until pretty recently, where when I would make a Let's Play video, it would be like the game, what episode it is, and then instead of having just like a generic title, it would kind of follow the chapter book format of like for example, like Legend of Zelda Part 1, in which this happens. I've always liked that. I've always kind of liked that naming thing from chapter books for, like, say, the Winnie the Pooh original book. I've always liked it where the chapter titles had kind of indications of what was going to happen in the chapter, so I adopted that originally because I'm like, this is so creative! Like, nobody else does this! Turns out, doesn't really attract people to the video, and it also means that so often I was struggling to find titles for my videos, just like what should the in which thing be today, and there was often a lot of duplicates between Let's Plays. So eventually I kind of switched over to the generic titles because those are a lot easier to come up with. They can be a bit more attention grabbing for people to be like, ooh, I'm gonna click on this, and it's less to read. So I still liked the old naming convention, but the current one just works better, so that's why I do it now. Not only that, but I'm sure you've also noticed that some of the content of my videos have also changed over time, as well as the upload frequency. My videos used to always be pretty short. It would be very rare if you ever saw a video from me that was over 30 minutes, which is amusing now that I upload content that's almost always much longer than that. And I guess the main reason for that is just, well, for one, back when I first started out my Let's Playing career, I was kind of struggling to figure out where I could record, because I started recording when I was in college, and I had 3 roommates, and I did not want to record in my dorm. Even if I had my own room, I knew all my roommates would be able to hear me, and I was very self-conscious about that, so I'm like, no, I'm not doing this. So often what I would have to do is I would have to book rooms in the school's library for, like, study purposes, but actually I would just Let's Play in there. I bet a lot of people walking by were just like, what is he doing in there? But at the very least, the rooms were soundproof, and that's what mattered to me. I was self-conscious. I didn't want other people to hear me while I was Let's Playing, and I honestly kind of still feel that way. So, and because I could only book the library rooms for, like, say, a half hour to an hour at a time, I was on a severe time limit to get the videos recorded and finished and get out of there before I no longer had the ability to record in the room. So that's the main reason why that my videos used to be a lot shorter. Also just because I thought, well, back then short videos were the norm on YouTube's. Like Chuck Conroy was also doing the same thing. So I'm like, yeah, this seems like it's the best way to do it. And also because my old editing software really didn't like rendering anything longer than 30 minutes. More on that later. The other thing that has changed is obviously my upload frequency. If you are one of the OG subscribers back from like my first year or two of Let's Playing, you'll remember that I used to upload way more frequently. Like, here's an idea, folks. I usually do about 8 to 10 Let's Plays a year. In my first year, I did 26 Let's Plays. Now granted, a lot of those Let's Plays were very, very short games that were only a couple of videos, but even so, like, now I'm on a very much a schedule where I'm like, for my Let's Plays, I upload 3 videos a week. Back then, it was like, oh, I have a video done and recorded, I'll just upload it right away. And there wasn't any rhyme or reason to it, it just meant that I was uploading like multiple times a day. Another reason I could do that is back in the day, I rendered those videos in 480p, which meant that they could render really quickly and they could upload really quickly. And because I was playing old games that didn't have great graphics anyways, I didn't feel bad about rendering them in 480p. Plus, my video rendering software really couldn't handle rendering anything more advanced than that. So yeah, that's how it went. Now that I obviously render things in HD, it takes a lot longer to render and upload videos. It usually takes several hours to render a half hour or a longer video, and usually I have to render videos either while I'm at work, while I'm at church, or while I'm asleep. So that, at the very least, limits how often I can upload now, but also I just want to have a more consistent schedule, and I don't want my life to be dominated by just recording and streaming Let's Plays all the time. Back in college, I really didn't have that. I really didn't have that problem. I wasn't super social in college, and I was pretty much on top of my schoolwork at all times, so pretty much when I had spare time, I was doing Let's Playing stuff. And honestly, looking back, I'm not gonna say I regret doing that, but I will say that if I was in college now, knowing what I know, I would definitely do it differently, and I would not spend nearly as much time on that. But hey, still no regrets. That's what I wanted to do back then, and I probably wouldn't have been able to be convinced otherwise. So, well, here we are. Another change that's happened over time was my streaming frequency as well as where I stream to, because, if you're one of the OG subscribers, you'll know that I have flip-flopped between where and how often I stream a lot. I actually started streaming in my first year of doing Let's Plays, and it was partway through the year, and I didn't stream a whole lot, just an occasional game, and usually just Lemmings. It was fun, but they were very, very sparse. They were not a regular thing. It was like, I'm feeling gracious tonight, so here, I'll be streaming. And then I kind of took a break, and then I came back to it. And originally, I streamed on Twitch, because basically that's where all the streamers went to. I didn't really have a huge preference, but I'm just like, oh yeah, everyone who games streams on Twitch. This was kind of before YouTube streaming became a pretty big thing, so you kind of had to do it on Twitch. Then once YouTube streaming actually kind of came out and became a bit more popular, I'm like, you know what, it makes more sense for me to just stream on YouTube, and that way I don't have to edit the videos, re-render them, and re-upload them, and more of my audience is on YouTube, so we're going to do it that way. Then later I went back to Twitch because I was disappointed by the lack of features that YouTube had. Like, I really liked how on Twitch you could like host other channels, you could raid other channels. I really liked the community aspect of that. I liked how you could have emotes, and just there were so many more options you could configure with Twitch, things like channel points. So I'm like, yeah, that's great, I'm going back to Twitch. And that's also when I started streaming a bit more regularly. It wasn't until a couple years back when I actually truly did make it like, okay, I'm gonna be streaming on Monday and Wednesday and on the weekend, and kind of committed to that 3 streams a week. So now I'm like, 3 Let's Play uploads a week, 3 streams a week. It's pretty regular, it's kind of a lot. I might dial it back in the future, but for now it's working and I can kind of balance my life with my Let's Play hobby. But yeah, and then later on, Twitch kind of started sucking. Twitch took away the ability to host, and honestly, there's been a lot of stuff happening with the Twitch company that I have not been a fan of. So at this point, I then decided, I'm like, you know, there's this Restream thing that lets you stream to both Twitch and YouTube, and Twitch definitely lessened up on its stream policy. You used to only be allowed to stream on Twitch if you were on Twitch, but now they're okay with us doing it to Twitch and YouTube at the same time. So that's what I'm doing. It's kind of best of both worlds. We still have the cool things like channel points and emotes when you watch me on Twitch, and you can also catch me on YouTube because I have way more followers on YouTube than I do on Twitch. So Yeah, that's how we're at. I honestly can say I like streaming more than I like Let's Playing at this point. It's a lot more fun for me to interact with chat, and I've definitely noticed over the several years I've been Let's Playing and making videos, I've definitely noticed that I'm not a super entertaining person on my own. A lot of my Let's Plays kind of devolve into me just kind of explaining and going over the mechanics of the game and giving you as much information out of it as possible. But I'm not super entertaining or funny by myself. I definitely find that I'm at my most entertaining when I either have someone else to play off of, like my sister Marty, again, more on that later, or if I can talk with Twitch chat, or if I'm playing just a game that allows me to have a lot of reactions to what's happening. And that's one of the reasons why my backyard baseball streams are doing so well, is because that's a game that's very much about reacting to weird stuff that happens. And yeah, it's great. And that's one of the reasons why I like streaming on Twitch and YouTube more than I like just recording in advance, because it gives me more opportunity to play off of people in chat, play off of the weird things that happen during the stream, whereas for my Let's Plays, I more like playing games that wouldn't really be as amusing to watch on stream. For example, in a game like, say, Kingdom Hearts Birth by Sleep, which I'm playing now, that involves lots and lots of grinding if you want to get everything, I don't really think that would be fun to watch on Twitch, just watching me for hours do the same level grinding, command grinding, all of that over and over again. So if it's a long game that I'm going to cut a lot of content out of, I'm gonna Let's Play it, but otherwise I'd probably prefer to stream it. Alright, so that's kind of an overview of my channel as a whole, as well as why I started. So now I kind of want to go back down memory lane and take a look at what I've done on my channel for Let's Plays and streams. Now, obviously, I've done a lot of Let's Plays and streams, so I'm not gonna have a huge, like, page and a half of research of, like, here's exactly what I think of each and every Let's Play and video I've ever made, because then you'd be here for days. So I will be skimming over most of the Let's Plays and stream series that I've done, and I'll only be talking a lot about Let's Plays that I think are particularly important for my career, or ones that I really, really enjoyed and want to talk about. So let's start with my very first Let's Play. Now, this was a big deal for me, for my first Let's Play, because I'd always thought of, like, oh man, this sounds cool, I want to do it, but also, I was an extremely nervous and shy person. Even when it was just me talking to the microphone by myself in a room alone, I was still super nervous to do it. And I wasn't entirely sure if I would even be able to do it, where I'm like, I'll probably be terrible, I'll be really awkward, and I won't be able to say anything. It took a lot of nerve for me to actually finally push those record buttons and start. And thankfully, Let's Playing was never easier for me, because all of the stuff that I used was free. Audacity, which I still use to this day, allowed me to record my voice, and then Open Broadcaster Studio, OBS, which is also free, and I also still use to this day, allowed me to record my computer screen. So as long as I was able to emulate something, I could play it. So I was basically determined to use the least amount of money possible for this, since I wasn't even sure if I would be able to do it or not. I basically finally committed. I'm like, all right, I'm going to reserve the library room. I'm going to record a episode. Worst case, if it's terrible, I don't have to upload it. Nobody even has to know. And that's kind of what helped me do that. And then after a while, I finally found my bearing and got a lot more comfortable with it. But for my first Let's Play, I knew that this was an important one, because I knew how hard it was to actually get noticed. And there were kind of a couple options for me. I could either play a popular game that everybody knew about and hope that people would get my Let's Play of it recommended when they were watching other videos about it. That's kind of risky if you're playing a game like Ocarina of Time, because how many thousands of Let's Plays of Ocarina of Time are there out there? You're not going to get found that way. The other option was to find a really obscure game that nobody else had Let's Played, but then nobody would really be looking for it because it's completely unknown. So I thought I was doing something really smart. My first Let's Play, I wanted to do a game that was relatively well known, but to play it in a way that was different, to put a spin on it that nobody had ever done before. And I was kind of inspired by this by Rome Mifral's Mega Man Perfect Runs. The no damage buster only Mega Man runs that he had done definitely was something that nobody else at that time had really had done, at least not with commentary. So that helped him stand out and also helped him become big. So I'm like, yeah, I'll kind of do something similar. So my first Let's Play I decided was going to be The Legend of Zelda, Oracle of Seasons, Cursed. Now, Cursed is the twist on it. Oracle of Seasons being a Legend of Zelda game that was made for the Game Boy Color, but the cursed aspect of it was I was playing for the whole game without getting any health increases and while always wearing the Cursed Ring. A ring which, when you wear it, will halve the damage you deal with your sword and double the damage you take from enemies. It was a challenging run, for sure, and it was something that I had even looked up in advance and nobody had done any videos on it, so I was excited. This was my chance to kind of show the world who I was. And here's the thing, and if you're somebody who is thinking about Let's Playing, I want to give a friendly word of encouragement to you. Your first Let's Play is going to suck. No, seriously, it will. Every single Let's Player I've ever talked to has always looked back at their first Let's Play and been like, oh my gosh, it was so bad, it's terrible, I cringe when I think about it. And yeah, so if you're gonna Let's Play, just know that your first Let's Play, and honestly probably your first several Let's Plays, are going to be bad. Because, and it's kind of inevitable, because it's your first time doing it, you're gonna be awkward, you don't really know how it all works. You don't know what to say, you're gonna be kind of naturally reserved unless you're like a particularly bombastic person, but it's like for the same reason that stand-up comics always fail inevitably for the first several times before they make it big. It's just, you gotta eventually know how to do it, and it's gonna take practice before you get better. So, honestly, for my first Let's Play though, I think it turned out alright. My gameplay, I'd actually say, was pretty good. Like, it was a really fun challenge. I enjoyed playing it. It was really tough, and there was definitely a lot of struggle that happened in it, but the actual gameplay was pretty good. The problem was me. For one, my first several Let's Plays, I mentioned earlier that I wanted to record with, like, the lowest possible cost, so my audio and video recording softwares were both free. The problem was, I had to actually have a microphone. Now, my laptop at the time had a built-in microphone, but boy, it sounded like you were talking through a washing machine on Mars, and nobody could understand me, so I'm like, alright, I'm gonna have to get a better mic. And I went on Amazon and I ordered the single cheapest microphone I could find. And it was $10, and it was terrible. I basically had to have it in my mouth in order for it to record my voice at all, and even when it was recording my voice, you could barely make out what I was saying, partly as a combination of the poor quality of the microphone, and partly because, well, it was my first Let's Play, I was really nervous, and I was a naturally shy person, so I was naturally mumbling my words. As a result, the audio quality of my voice is pretty much unwatchable for the first many Let's Plays I've done, but the Oracle of Seasons Cursed Let's Play in particular is absolutely egregious, and even though I think that this challenge was really good, I can confidently say that I hate my first Let's Play. You should not watch it. It is terrible quality. Don't watch it. And also, by the way, folks, my plan backfired anyways. I thought, oh, hey, Oracle of Seasons. People know Oracle of Seasons, kind of. And this is a unique theme. Like, this will be something that people could actually end up accidentally stumbling onto. No, they didn't. I don't think anybody has watched this Let's Play of mine, and I'm glad for it. Let's keep it that way, alright? Don't watch it. I know that saying, telling people not to watch something is going to cause them to look it up and watch it, but no, just don't. Take it from me. I was the one who made it. The voice recording is bad. In fact, this is one of those Let's Plays where I'm like, maybe I should redo this. Honestly, maybe I should redo it. Except the challenge was really hard, and I actually did have to resort to save states at some point. Just to make sure if I died, I wouldn't have to, like, you know, climb back all the way to the top of the ancient ruins, or I wouldn't have to fight the first two phases of the final boss in order to try his dark dragon form again. Because, boy, that final boss was really, really tough. Took me a long time. Almost ran out of time in the library room, but I finally beat it. And while I can say it was a proud achievement of mine, this was not a good Let's Play. But of course, Oracle of Seasons wasn't the only Legend of Zelda game that I played. Exactly 1 year later, on my 1 year Let's Playing anniversary, I started to do the same thing, but with Oracle of Ages. Same challenge, no heart container increases, and half damage of your sword, double damage from enemies. This one turned out a lot better. For one, I had a year of Let's Playing experience under my belt, so I was a lot more confident in who I was, and a lot more, I'll say myself, a lot less awkward, a lot less shy. The other reason being that at this point I had upgraded my microphone, and it didn't sound like a washing machine on Earth. Because that's basically the difference. My laptop's microphone was a washing machine on Mars, and the first microphone I got was a washing machine on Earth. The new one actually has better sound quality, and this is actually a Let's Play that I'd say is quite watchable. I don't think it's particularly entertaining, but the challenge is cool, so if you want to watch me do it, don't watch the Seasons one, watch the Ages one, it's a lot better. I also played Zelda 1 and 2 on my channel at some point, but honestly, I don't really remember those. Not very memorable, not super entertaining, but hey, if you want to see somebody play these really hard games, they're available. Obviously, my favorite thing I've done for Zelda are the Zelda randomizers, Link to the Past, Ocarina of Time, and Majora's Mask. I guess I also did the Oracle game randomizers, but those aren't as fun. My favorite, obviously, is Ocarina of Time, but Majora is a close second. These are really fun because they take some of my favorite games, and they make it so that they're slightly different every single time you play it. It adds new twists, it keeps it fresh, and as a result, it's like I'm playing my favorite games for the first time over and over again. They're so fun. They're so fun. Maybe they're not as entertaining as a lot of my other content, but hey, I always enjoy playing these, and they're a very fun reoccurring stream series that I do. One other thing you may not know is that I actually made a video of me playing Ocarina of Time with two other people, Messi and Nintendo Addict, and we were actually trying to have a race to see who could beat the game first. We recorded our first video, and I believe I got through the Child Link section entirely, and I can't actually remember where the other two ended off, but we basically had to break at the end of the Child section, and we all thought that we would go back and we would record the rest, and then we never ever did. As a result, this video is probably the most obscure video on my entire channel. You really can't look it up, because it's not in any of my playlists. You literally just have to dig through all of my videos in order to find it. We never actually continued it because, well, the three of us never really got back together. We didn't have a whole lot of interest in finishing it, and also because Nintendo Addict couldn't record his footage and play it at the same time because his PC was too low quality. Honestly, I even forgot about this one until I got a comment, a YouTube notification that there was a comment on my video. I'm like, oh my gosh, I totally forgot about this. I thought this was one of those things that I recorded but just never uploaded. Actually, I had just forgotten I had even done it in the first place, but yeah, that happened. But now that we're done with Zelda, it's time to talk about one of the biggest aspects of my channel over the years, lemmings. Now, my second Let's Play ever, which was done at the exact same time as my Oracle of Seasons 1 after I'd uploaded many videos, was Lemmings. Now, Lemmings, for those of you who don't know, is a very old side-scrolling puzzle game where you have to control a bunch of little lemmings who wander around aimlessly and help them perform tasks in order to get to the exit while avoiding dying in a variety of ways. It's a pretty simple and very, very fun puzzle game, and growing up, it was actually one of the first two video games that I have a recollection of playing, and I have hugely fond memories of playing this with my family and us trying to get through these brutally difficult puzzles. I always really enjoyed it, and I kind of wanted to play it. Now, this honestly, despite being my second Let's Play, possibly my most important Let's Play that I ever did. Now again, quality-wise, this Let's Play was not good. I was still using the $10 microphone with bad audio quality, and I was still very shy and awkward, although at least a little bit more confident now that I had recorded a couple of videos for Oracle of Seasons. Keep in mind, folks, that early on in my Let's Playing career, I was Let's Playing and uploading multiple videos from different Let's Plays simultaneously, so I was playing this and Oracle of Seasons at the same time. Now, the reason why this was so important was mainly because how I was playing the game. If you know anything about Lemmings, you'll know that it got ported to pretty much every single system that existed from the 80s till the first half of the 90s. Ew, it was on NES? Yep. Super NES? Yep. Every single computer ever made? Yep. PlayStation? Yep. Genesis? Yep. Name a system, Lemmings was probably released for it. But I was not playing it on any of the official ports, but I was playing it on a very special application that a bunch of fans had made called Super Lemmini. And this was a Java-based application that allowed you to run Lemmings with higher quality graphics, higher quality music, a lot of customization options, custom levels were possible, it also had things like directional select and a fast forward button, and you could assign skills while paused. It was just a huge quality of life improvement. Now, because this was a system that was made by fans, nobody had ever really played on it before, and this proved to accidentally be one of my best decisions I made while Let's Playing. Because I played it on Super Lemmini, somebody ended up finding it. There was somebody by the name of Iho Tolot. He was somebody from the Lemmings forums, and he found my videos, I can only assume, because he's like, wait, somebody's playing on Super Lemmini? This is something that we made, wait, what? And then he found my channel and he kind of said, like, oh man, this guy likes lemons too. He likes Super Lemon Eye. I'll invite him to the forums. And I'm just like, yeah, I got a comment from him just saying, like, hey, you should check out the lemons forums. I'm like, okay, yeah, why not? I like lemons. What's the worst that could be? What's the worst that could happen? Well, this turned out to be a great decision. This was the first online community I'd ever joined, and I was immediately surrounded by a bunch of people who loved lemons as much as I did. And I made a lot of great friends on the forums, and some of them are still my good friends to this day. So that's awesome. And what more importantly is, this is really where I first got my audience. I said before that nobody watched my Oracle of Seasons Let's Play, but people took notice of my Lemmings Let's Play. Partly because I actually recorded it on the anniversary of Lemmings, which happens to be Valentine's Day. But yeah, joining the Lemmings forums was great. I got to meet other people. People became aware of who I was and my content and actually started watching it. And that was kind of the very beginning of it all. I got my first subscribers, I got my first views, and things just started progressing from there. Now, I mentioned before that I really enjoyed Lemmings, and if you are familiar with my early Let's Playing career, you know I played a lot of Lemmings. In my first year of Let's Playing alone, I played Lemmings and Lemmings Revolution, which are two official Lemmings games, but I also played a variety of fan packs, including Pimo Lems, Lemmings Plus One, and Sub Lems, which is actually a pack that I had made on my own in my spare time. Now, obviously, I played these because I really, really liked Lemmings. It was a really fun puzzle game. I couldn't believe that I could actually play these custom levels that Round the Wheel had made when I watched his videos. And honestly, my first custom pack that I played, PMOMs, I mainly Let's Played it just because Round the Wheel had started Let's Playing it, but never ever got around to finishing it, and I wanted to be the first one to have a finished Let's Play of PMOMs on my channel, because that was widely regarded as a pretty tough pack. Nowadays, it's certainly not one of the harder packs, but it was at the time. Of course, these early videos still had pretty bad audio quality, but whatever. Lemmings Plus One was a fun pack, probably my favorite custom pack that I played. It was fun, challenging, not unfair, pretty simple, pretty quick, and it was honestly just the perfect length. If it was any longer, it would be a little bit excessive, but taught me some valuable tricks, and it was just very, very enjoyable to play, all things considered. Lemmings Revolution, on the other hand, was a huge pain in the butt to play. Lemmings Revolution, like I said, is an official Lemmings game that was made as a sequel. It's got a 3D aspect, and the main gimmick is that you can rotate this tube that the Lemmings are walking on, and basically they can walk off the edge of one side and pop up on the edge of the other. It also has a bunch of other gimmicks. Lemmings Revolution is kind of infamous among the community for being notoriously nearly impossible to play on modern machines, and boy did I feel that. I was determined to play it and finally beat it, because this was a game I had growing up, never came close to beating it. I had to install like 5 separate patches to Lemmings Revolution just to get it to run, and even then, not every level ran. One of the levels crashed every time that I tried to play it, but apparently it did that on the main game, even in the official release anyway, so that was not the fault of any patches or my modern machine. That was just Lemmings Revolution not being programmed properly. Honestly, this Let's Play was alright. I mean, again, I'm one of the only people who's actually done an English commentary of Lemmings Revolution, so you don't have a whole lot of options. The audio quality is at least a lot better than for a lot of my other Let's Plays at the time. But, and honestly, one of my most legendarily funny moments was from this LP, which was my reaction to Lemmings drowning in dirt via a glitch. Yeah, people still bring this up to this day. I'm glad people enjoyed it so much. However, you'll probably notice that I'm not really playing Lemmings anymore. Well, that's for a variety of reasons. The next year, my second year, I played Seb Lems by Flopsy. This was a huge pack. It was a lot of fun, but it was huge. Way bigger than any Lemmings pack I did before, and it took me ages to finish it, and it got really hard later on. Not only that, but afterwards I also played Lemmings World Tour, which was the final Lemmings LP I ever did, and it was even bigger, having hundreds of levels to the point where I literally split the Let's Play up into two parts separated by over a year. Yeah. Oh, and that wasn't all. The Lemmings forums also hosted contests as well, where people had to make custom levels according to specific rules, and I often entered these contests and played these contest levels as well. Not only that, but I also have my first streams ever were me accepting custom levels that people had made in Lemmings and sending them to me, and I'd play them live on stream. It was really fun, I really enjoyed those, but as you can see, that's a lot of Lemmings! And eventually, I just burned out on it. Eventually, I just kind of got tired of playing Lemmings. I'd played it so much, and I'd just kind of seen all I'd ever wanted to see of Lemmings, and I was honestly just kind of done. My own level pack had been finished. My second level pack that I planned had to be released unfinished because I just was out of ideas. And at this point, I just had simultaneous Lemmings burnout, as well as the fact that I didn't want to be known as the guy who played Lemmings online. I've never wanted to be known as the guy who plays one thing. I've always liked playing a variety of stuff, so I was pretty well aware that most of my viewers early on came from the Lemmings forums and primarily watched me for my Lemmings content. And I also knew that my Lemmings content was not attracting other viewers to me at all. If you liked Lemmings, you were already on the Lemmings forums, or you just didn't know it, because Lemmings was released in the 80s. Long before I was born. So, people these days who are watching YouTube just were not looking for Lemmings content, and I wanted to do other things, so that's ultimately why I stopped playing Lemmings. I also played Lix multiplayer for a time. Now, Lix is basically Lemmings just made by a different guy. It's open source, and it's got a couple of differences, but basically the main feature that it has that Lemmings doesn't is multiplayer. And I played multiplayer a few times, and I had actually a few videos up for it, but I actually have since taken them down for a couple of reasons. For one, I just don't enjoy playing Lix multiplayer. I like Lemmings because I can take my time with it. I can pause, think about my moves, and try some stuff out. But whereas Lemmings multiplayer, or Lix multiplayer in this case, you can't pause. It's just chaos, and I can't process that. It's so radically different from how I play Lemmings. And the reason I took the videos down is just because there were swear words in the chat that I wasn't actually able to filter out. And this was before I figured out the solution of just saying, hey, just put a T rating on the video. But no, since then I've taken them down. Nobody really watched them anyways. Another issue with Let's Playing Lemmings is the fact that, at least to me, Lemmings was just not that fun to watch. Now, don't get me wrong, I mentioned before that I enjoyed watching Round the Wheels custom Lemmings levels videos, right? Well, those were simultaneously short, the packs that he played were pretty short, and he was pretty good at solving the levels. He also would cut out extensive periods of time where he was spent thinking, but I find that when I play Lemmings, especially once the levels get hard, most of the video is just me sitting there thinking, what do I do? That's the problem with playing puzzle games on your channel when you haven't actually solved the puzzles before. They make for long and rather dull videos. Obviously, some people disagree on this, and I get it. Some people really like watching my thought process and trying different things, but I honestly just thought that this didn't make for very entertaining content, which was another reason why I kind of burned out on Lemmings. So now that we've covered the Lemmings part of this video, it's time to look at our third Let's Play, Donkey Kong Country 1. Honestly, there's not a whole lot to say about this. I really like Donkey Kong Country 1. I played it for the Game Boy Advance because that was the version I grew up with, but it was just kind of nondescript. Again, not a whole lot happened. Later on, I streamed this when playing it on hard mode, which was a lot better, but still not super descriptive. Later on, though, I played Donkey Kong Country 2, which was another turning point for me, because this was the Let's Play during which I got my new headset and upgraded my microphone at last. And fun fact, the headset that I got for my birthday, which is what I ultimately used partway through my Donkey Kong Country 2 Let's Play to get better audio quality, is actually the exact same model of Logitech headset that I still use today for my streams. So, clearly it worked. Also, funny story, my older brother gave that to me for my birthday, and I started testing it out, and I'm like, bro, this new microphone you gave me stinks. Its sound quality is completely different from my main microphone. And he's like, oh, really? That stinks. And he kind of listened to a sample of me on my original microphone and a sample of me on the new microphone. And he's like, Arty, the old microphone is the one that's terrible. Like, your sound coming through the headset that I gave you is literally how you sound in real life. Your old microphone is making you sound deeper and worse than you actually are. And I'm like, oh. And yeah, I don't use my old microphone anymore. However, the Logitech headset was still pretty reasonable. I know it's certainly not an expensive headset. It's like $30, but the audio quality is solid and it's fairly comfortable to wear. So yeah, I mean, the first couple videos of my Donkey Kong Country 2 Let's Play still have the old $10 washing machine microphone, but after you get to a certain point, the audio quality gets a noticeable increase. Although it also means my voice gets quieter, but it's still a lot better to hear. Honestly, DK Country 2 is also a fairly non-descriptive Let's Play. However, it did have a couple of funny moments. One moment that always stands out to me is that there was one funny part where I, died, then I respawned in the star barrel, and then immediately cartwheeled into the lava. That was funny. But beyond that, it was just kind of another Let's Play. I also played Donkey Kong Country 3 a lot later in my Let's Playing hobby. And honestly, I felt the quality here was pretty solid all the way through. It just wasn't super great, but it also wasn't bad in any way either. But hey, the hard mode stream was also fun as well. However, before Donkey Kong Country 3, I also Let's Played Donkey Kong 64, which is another turning point for me. This was the first Let's Play I did using a capture card, which I also had gotten for my birthday. And I was excited. Donkey Kong 64 is consistently one of my favorite games, and I really, really enjoyed playing it. And this was not just any Let's Play of Donkey Kong 64. It was a Let's Play of me going through the whole game without collecting a single golden banana. This is another kind of challenge mode that I thought was similar to my Oracle of Seasons Cursed initial Let's Play, and I thought this one would get some more attention. For one, I was a lot better at Let's Playing now. Two, I had a better headset. Three, I had a capture card. And four, this was again a game that everybody knew, but very few people had actually taken the challenge. However, surprisingly, not really anybody has seen this Let's Play, which is a shame. I actually think this is a pretty good Let's Play. It's not the best, but it's a cool challenge. And even though there were a couple of parts that were frustrating, specifically trying to get through this wall in Angry Aztec because I couldn't save Diddy without collecting a golden banana, and trying to get through Hideout Helm in 10 minutes was definitely really, really annoying. But it was a fun challenge, and I would actually do it again. And obviously, I also enjoy playing Donkey Kong 64 randos from time to time. Again, I love Donkey Kong 64. The randomizer adds a lot of quality of life improvements that make it even more fun. And again, I just love this game. Love coming back to it, man. I also Let's Play Diddy Kong Racing in my second year, and this is actually an interesting Let's Play because this was actually the result of a poll that I did on the Lemmings forums. Because again, back then the Lemmings forums were basically my entire viewer base, and I was curious, alright folks, I kind of want to play Diddy Kong Racing, I kind of want to play Banjo-Kazooie, and I kind of want to play Yoshi's Island. Which one would people want to see? And Diddy Kong Racing ended up winning the poll, but just barely. So I basically made the promise of, okay, I'll Let's Play Diddy Kong Racing, and then shortly afterwards I'll Let's Play Banjo and Yoshi. Well, I did play Banjo and Yoshi, but it was not immediately afterwards. In fact, Banjo I recorded like 2 or 3 years after Diddy Kong Racing, and I didn't play Yoshi's Island until even later than that, and that didn't happen in a Let's Play, that happened on a stream, so whoops! Never let it be said that Arty doesn't keep his word, though. I did play them, eventually. My actual Diddy Kong Racing Let's Play was pretty interesting. I enjoyed it, and I thought it was a decent quality all around. Although my stream of Playing It Adventure 2 was probably even better. Just better content, better challenge, and I was a more interesting person then, so there you go. I also was a lot more knowledgeable about the game when I played Adventure 2, so a lot of the information I give in my main Let's Play, probably outdated or incorrect. Also, my brother and I played Donkey Kong Barrel Blast, but nobody remembers this video. Not even me. My fourth Let's Play was Mega Man, and I'll just cut to the chase. I've played the first 4 Mega Man games on my channel. None of these are particularly interesting Let's Plays. Like I said, I've Let's Played Mega Man because I love Mega Man, but the Let's Plays just weren't very good. They're boring, you don't have to bother playing them. Having said that, I also did speedrun Mega Man Rock Force a couple of times. This is a fan game which I strongly believe is better than any official Mega Man game ever made. I love it a lot. I honestly might go back to it someday, but these were fun videos. I strongly recommend playing this fan game if you love Mega Man. And the speedruns are super fun as well, because you get to play as a bunch of different characters, so maybe I'll go back to it again. Also, because it's a Mega Man fan game and I actually did speedruns of it, people actually have seen it! So that's pretty cool. Oh yeah. This one. So, not technically a Mega Man game, but another game that I played during my first year was Mighty No. 9. Now, I mentioned at the beginning of this video that I'm not a guy who really likes to live with regrets. Even when I spent more time Let's Playing in college than I probably should have, I wouldn't say I regret that. I don't regret most things in my life. This is an exception. Mighty No. 9, I can confidently say, is the only Let's Play I've done that I genuinely regret doing, and I truly wish I had never Let's Played it and had never uploaded it. For starters, I Let's Played this on the Wii U mainly because I'm like, it's like a spiritual successor to Mega Man! I love Mega Man! This is gonna be great! It was not great. It was not great at all. This game at this point is pretty infamous for being disappointing, to say the least. Yeah, this game is not very good. It's way worse than Mega Man. The level design is terrible. It abuses instant death to a ridiculous degree. I died so many times. The sound quality is not particularly great. The graphics aren't particularly great. And I raged a lot in this game. I have honestly multiple times debated going back and just deleting all of these videos. Because A, nobody watched these. And B, I hate them. Of course, now that I've drawn attention to the fact, people will probably start flocking to these and looking at them. Now, having said that, thinking back on it, Mighty No. 9 did have one very minor turning point for me, which is, I believe this was the first Let's Play I did where I actually did custom thumbnails. Everything up to this point, all of the thumbnails on my videos before this, had been the result of me just choosing one of the three randomly selected YouTube suggested thumbnails, which meant that in my first Let's Play of Oracle Seasons, quite a few of my thumbnails actually were kind of the same. But here, I actually made an effort to screenshot the intro screen for each boss to use those as the thumbnails. So I guess it has that going for it. It's still a terrible Let's Play in a bad game. Don't play it. Don't watch it. Okay, let's stop focusing on the negative and let's go to the part of the Let's Playing career that probably most people know about. My humongous entertainment Let's Plays. These are definitely my most well-known Let's Plays by far, and also probably overall the most popular ones as well. And I think I know why. The Humongous Entertainment games, at least at the time where I recorded them, were kind of the perfect combination of short and fun, so it wasn't a huge commitment to watch them. They were also niche enough that not really anybody else at the time I recorded these had Let's Played them, but they were also still somehow well-known enough that everybody recognized them and were like, oh my gosh, Putt-Putt, Fatty Bear, I remember these games, and it's only like a couple short videos. I'm totally gonna watch this. So, as a result, these ended up becoming some of my most popular Let's Plays and definitely helped me build a lot of that 1,000 subscriber audience, so thank you all for that. And honestly, if we were to go through some of the Humongous Entertainment Let's Plays, pretty much all of them I look back on favorably. Putt-Putt Enters the Parade and Fatty Bear's Birthday Surprise are two of my favorite games of all time, and even though both of these games involved me using my terrible washing machine $10 online Amazon microphone, there's still two of the only Let's Plays where I use that microphone that I'd actually say are still potentially worth going back and watching. Yeah, the audio quality is terrible, but honestly, you can kind of live without it. I love these games so much, they're short, and a lot of amusing stuff happened in both of these, so I actually would recommend going back and watching these if you are interested, obviously. If you're a Humongous Entertainment fan and you are like, I never actually saw you play these, well, you can check them out. Audio quality is pretty bad, but the content, I think, is actually pretty good. I could say the same for Putt-Putt Goes to the Moon, another one of my favorite games. This game is gorgeous. Still has the bad audio quality, however, when I played Putt-Putt Goes to the Moon, I also made the mistake of playing Bear Stormin'. For those of you who don't know, but have probably heard me talk about it at some point, Bear Stormin' is a mini arcade minigame within Putt-Putt Goes to the Moon, where you play as Fatty Bear piloting an airplane. Now, I decided, you know what, I'm gonna Let's Play through all of Bear Stormin', because there's a bunch of levels in it, and it is a full game, and you can actually save your progress in between the levels, and I definitely didn't think anybody had done that before, so I'm like, yeah, this is gonna be great, it's gonna be fun, I love Fatty Bear, I love hitting the ducks, this is gonna be great. It wasn't great. It was funny for the first little bit, but then it got boring, and then the game turned, like, sadistically difficult. Like, to this day, Bear Stormin', possibly the most difficult game I've ever played and beaten. Like, I'm actually not joking about that. It's super short, but dear lord, what they put in this game, it reminds you of like the most sadistic Kaizo level ROM hacks eventually. Like, there's a level where you literally have to fly absolutely perfectly in order to win, and it's a long level. And keep in mind, the controls in Bear Stormin' are terrible. You have to use the mouse to move up and down, and it's super imprecise, and you have to fly with precision in order to beat it. Or hey, let's not forget the level where there's just cannonballs constantly getting launched at you at such a high speed that unless you just know exactly where they're coming at what times, you'll never avoid them in time. And let's not forget the level that includes cannonballs within the balloons you need to pick up to get fuel. Yeah, that was fair. Seriously, this game made me rage more than any other game ever has. In fact, there was a video that I made of Bear Stormin' that was never uploaded because A, I didn't make any progress in it. I think I just spent the whole time trying to beat a single level, level 43. I believe that was the level title. And it actually amounted to me pounding on the table in frustration. Afterwards, I'm just like, I regret acting like that. I'm embarrassed, and I never uploaded it. But yeah, if you hear me talking about how annoying Bearstorm was, you now know what it is, and to avoid it. Putt-Putt and Fatty Bear's activity pack was fun. A lot of the mini games in that were just kind of boring, but hey, I had a lot of funny moments playing Go Fish against Fatty Bear, with him asking me if I had any fish, like, literally 10 times in a row. I thought I broke his AI at some point. But yeah, that was a fun one. Freddy Fish 1 was an interesting one-off Let's Play I did, and this was actually my very first time I ever recorded with my sister Marty, and this was kind of something that I'm like, at this point my family kind of knew I was Let's Playing. I kept it a bit of a secret at first, but it eventually came out, and then it was my sister Marty's birthday, and I'm just like, hey Marty, would you like to record Freddy Fish 1 with me? And she's like, yes! And we started, and I think this is a really good decision. Marty is always a delight to have on. As I said before, I find that I'm most entertaining when I can play off of someone or something. Marty and I play off each other well, and it makes for some very funny times. Having said that, Freddy Fish 1, it definitely had a lot of funny moments. Again, our first time interacting with each other, which was pretty nice on screen. The main issue is we were still using the $10 microphone, and now not only did I have to use the $10 microphone, my sister had to share the $10 microphone with me. The one that we basically had to have in our mouths in order for it to register. What happened was that Marty was often just not close enough to the microphone, and a lot of her voices just cannot actually be heard, but it was still fun. Puppet Saves the Zoo was a fun series. I mean, I love that game. I also did a video where I sped up a lot of the game just by holding the shift key, because apparently if you hold the shift key on my copy of the game, it speeds everything up. So that was funny. My only regret for this Let's Play is I wasn't able to show off all of the secrets. There's a lot of secrets in this game where you have to, like, add stuff to the code arbitrarily in order to find it, and I wasn't able to get that to work, and also that Marty was never able to join in. She loves Puppet Saves the Zoo, but there's only one path, so if I were to do that again today, I would have made sure that she was included on the path to begin with, but well. Puppet Travels Through Time was probably my weakest Puppet Let's Play. Apparently a lot of people enjoyed it, and it's one of my more reviewed Let's Plays, but honestly, I don't remember a whole lot of funny stuff happening here, except Marty and me making the picture books in the library. Though that was funny, but the rest of it was just kind of eh. Also, I want to highlight something for those of you who don't know. So, Puppet Travels Through Time was the first Puppet game that had multiple paths. Basically, for those of you who don't know, the premise of the game is Puppet's school supplies get sucked through a time portal and he has to get them all back. There are four different time periods you can go to, and each of the things you lose can end up in each different time portal, which requires different puzzles in order to solve. I wanted to show off all of the paths, so I was trying to basically keep resetting the game until we got the right RNG manipulation so that each of the stuff was in each location. I reset the game 100 times, and the calculator never showed up in the Old West. I don't know how that's happened, but that's what caused me to finally download ScumVM, which allows you to emulate the Humongous Entertainment games and manipulate the RNG, so yeah, that happened. Freddy Fish 2 is also one of my weakest Humongous Entertainment Let's Plays, but Marty was there, so that kind of made things interesting. The audio quality was a bit better. At this point, Marty and I were sharing the headset that I had, which was better audio quality, but Marty was still really quiet. Not a whole lot happened in Freddy Fish 2, though. Pajama Sam 1 was a good Let's Play, and this might be my most viewed Let's Play of all time. Certainly one of them. And yeah, Pajama Sam 1 is just a great game. Marty joined me for the second path. It was fun. It was great. Alright, the Spy Fox games are obviously some of my favorite games to Let's Play. I love because there are so many bad puns in these games, I added a bad pun counter to all of them, and that was one of the people's favorite parts of that. I know I didn't get every bad pun because there's still some that I didn't catch, but it was a great addition. These games are hilarious, and Spy Fox 1 is one of my most viewed videos of all time, at least the first part. So, I got to show off every path, there was some funny stuff that happened, and yeah, all three of them are very interesting, so you should definitely keep those in mind. I also played Puppet and Pep's Balloonorama, which is an arcade game. Yeah, this is boring, don't watch it. Dog on a Stick was a lot less boring, but so you can watch it. And at the very least, I was able to show off my custom levels and true statistics, so that was funny. Freddy Fish 3 was a pretty decent one. I would say it was definitely better than Freddy Fish 2, but as far as my Humongous Entertainment Let's Plays go, it wasn't super memorable. But I mean, hey, it was a Let's Play. Alright, folks, I'm gonna be honest with you. I actually completely forgot that I even recorded and Let's Play Pajama Sam 2. Literally, Marty and I, like, fairly recently, we were just kind of, like, together, like, did we ever actually record Pajama Sam 2? And we did! The fact that I forgot about it seems to mean that not really anything interesting happened. Which is a shame, because Pajama Sam 2 is such a good game, but oh well, it exists. Okay, we got Maze Madness. Freddy Fish and Luther's Maze Madness, one of my all-time favorite games. One of my favorite humongous entertainment games. It's like a Pac-Man style game where you just swim through a maze and collect kelp seeds. But the level design's great, and I like it so much that I actually played a fan game of Maze Madness. See, at the one of the things about Maze Madness is there's a custom level editor and then a secret custom level editor. I actually made a tutorial on how to use the secret level editor because it was really complicated. And I mentioned at the end of it, I'm like, if people want to make custom levels and make their own level pack, I will play it. And somebody made their own custom level packs and I played it. And it was fun. I mean, it got super difficult, but it was definitely interesting. And that's honestly one of the things that I've really enjoyed the most about Let's Playing was getting to interact with fans and like play stuff like this. Like, I literally played something nobody else had ever played before, and it was just a labor of love. It was awesome. I would love to play more like unique fan projects like that. That's so great. If you're out there, man, like, that was truly a delight to play. I appreciate it, and it was one of the coolest things I've done Let's Playing, I would say. All right, folks, Putt-Putt Enters the Race. I'm gonna say it right now, one of my best Let's Plays I have ever done. Now, my general rule of thumb for my Humongous Entertainment Let's Plays is if it's a game that's linear with only one path, I generally play it with Marty, and if it's a game with multiple paths, I play the first path with myself and the rest of it with Marty. Now, my first playthrough of Putt-Putt Enters the Race with the first path was alright. It was informative, but not great. Folks, just skip to the part where Marty comes on. Trust me, some of the funniest content I've ever made. It's hysterical. I drop it right now and watch it. It's amazing. You've got to watch it. It's so good. And speaking of amazing, Freddy Fish 4, another one of my best Let's Plays. And again, right when Marty came around is when everything got way funnier. Literally, the game just falls apart when Marty joins, and it's glorious. I don't even want to spoil it. If you haven't seen Freddy Fish 4 and my Let's Play of it, you gotta go. Puppet Joins the Circus was honestly a pretty good Let's Play, even if it was a little short. That game I consider one of the weaker ones, so the fact that Marty and I were able to make it so entertaining, I think, is a big plus. Similarly, Pajama Sam 3 was another good one. It's just a fun game. Marty made it super fun. You should watch it. Freddy Fish 5 was also pretty fun, because when Marty ended up playing it with me, she had never played it before, so getting to see her reactions to a lot of the crazy stuff that happens was pretty enjoyable. I also hadn't played it in a while, so it was more blind than a lot of our Let's Plays. My Sockworks stream was honestly kind of boring, because Sockworks is kind of boring, but definitely the highlight was my sister making me play God Shattering Star during it. Yeah, that was pretty funny. Marty and I also explored the farm with Buzzy the Knowledge Bug, and that one was pretty well received. A lot of people really liked this one, despite it being a very blatantly educational game, and we will definitely be playing the other two Buzzy games in the future. Don't worry about that. Okay, the Blue's Clues games as well. Humongous Entertainment made some games based off of the TV show Blue's Clues, and oh boy, I've got some stories for this one. So let's start with Blue's Clues Birthday. So Blue's Clues Birthday was one of those games I had growing up, and I actually ended up getting it again as an adult because we lost the discs and I wanted to play it again. Now, there are two different discs for it, the yellow disc and the red disc. The game is slightly different depending on which disc that you play. And I actually played this game twice, both for my birthday. I believe I played it for my 23rd birthday and then my 24th birthday. And the red disc playthrough for my 24th birthday was fine, went off without a hitch. But the one I did of the yellow disc on my 23rd birthday was the only video I've ever made that actually just got taken down. Like, literally YouTube didn't just... Now, I've gotten copyright strikes before where it's like, oh, you can't monetize this video. Or like, oh, we're gonna have to play ads on this video because you use copyrighted content. And I'm like, okay, yeah, that's fine. I don't monetize my videos, and if you want to play ads, whatever. That's fine. Still fair use. No. Me playing Blue's Clues Birthday Yellow Disc, the only time YouTube actually said, you used copyrighted content, we are making your video impossible to watch for anybody. And I'm just like, what? Why? And I didn't even know this happened until, like, late last year, where I just was looking at, like, copyright strikes, and they're like, Blue's Clues Birthday, you can't watch. I don't even know how long it was like that, but apparently nobody's been able to really watch it for a while. And I actually had a dispute with YouTube because they're like, you use copyrighted music. I'm like, I was talking over the whole video. There is no way this does not fall under fair use. And I actually didn't get it available again. So for those of you who never saw it, go back and watch it. It was great. Blue's Clues birthday games are great, except one thing that I learned is that I was too stupid for them. These games were made for people ages 3 to 8, and I was too stupid to solve them. I was never able to find all of the noisemakers. I just had to get the normal ending. Also, Steve looking like he was literally ripped outright with a Xerox was kind of funny. Blue's Clues ABC Time Activities was a short one, but a fun one. Not too long, just kind of short and sweet. Okay, Pajama Sam's Lost and Found is way worse than I remember, but hey, the terrible hitbox is made for some funny moments, and I liked going over the real-life Arty lore in the final video, where I basically talked a little bit more about myself and where I was, so you can watch it for that! And also, it was great chatting with people in Twitch chat who also were like, what is this game? So, thank you. Alright, Putt-Putt Pep's birthday surprise. I'll be honest, I thought this game was going to suck. Actually, way better than I remember, and it made a fantastic Let's Play. Marty and I made this game hilarious. Even if you don't like this game normally, you should watch it. It's funny. Okay, now obviously the thing I'm most known for now is my Backyard Baseball streams. These are some of my favorite streams to do. I absolutely love it. Going for the whole season of Backyard Baseball is really fantastic. It always makes for really hilarious moments. And it always gets a good turnout in stream chat, so that's awesome. I love interacting with people. I am getting a little worried about it, though, for two reasons. One is kind of like I brought up in my Lemmings section. I don't want to be known as the guy who just plays Backyard Baseball. I don't want people to be, like, expecting, like, come on, play Backyard Baseball. I don't care about anything else. Just play Backyard Baseball. Like, I don't want to end up in that situation. Another thing I want to point out is that the Backyard Baseball videos take a long time to edit. Because Backyard Baseball is one of the few series that I actually do take a lot of time to put into editing, cutting out unnecessary stuff, adding in funny effects. It makes the stream, the YouTube VODs, a lot more funny to watch and a lot more enjoyable to watch, but it takes a lot of time. So it's a big time commitment for me to actually play Backyard Baseball. I still absolutely love playing it. I still want to play it more, but I am getting a little more cautious of being like, I don't want to play it too much. Having said that, it is hilarious, and I will be doing a season 5 sometime this year. I don't know when, but I will, so keep your eyes peeled for that, and if you have never joined and you're interested, definitely join. They're hilarious, and if you join in the first stream, you get to have some input. I also streamed Backyard Soccer once, but man, that game was boring. Way worse than I remember. It was a shame. Another group of Let's Plays that I did were Mario Let's Plays, and honestly my first Mario Let's Play was Super Mario World, or rather Super Mario Advance 2, and that was like Let's Play 20-something, and which is weird, like I went super long without playing a Mario game, even though I'm a huge Mario fan, so that was kind of weird. Honestly, Mario Advance 2, Mario World, that was a fun Let's Play. Wasn't spectacular, maybe a bit boring, but I thought the gameplay was pretty good, and I just really enjoy it. I also have played Paper Mario multiple times on my channel. It's my number 2 favorite game of all time, so naturally I love playing it any chance I get. I think my actual Let's Play Paper Mario turned out pretty good. I was very knowledgeable about the game, so I taught people a lot of cool stuff. Some interesting and funny stuff happened, like me intentionally eating a fire pop at 1 HP and dying because of it. And yeah, it was just a fun time. And it was the last video of my first year of Let's Playing was Paper Mario, so that's pretty cool. I also went back and later streamed Paper Mario, but doing a level 0 challenge, where basically I went for the whole game without being able to level up, and without my partners being able to level up. And actually, that was a super fun challenge. I thought it would be like stupidly difficult, and it definitely was difficult, but it was like really, really good and a fun way to play. Honestly, I would totally play it again if it weren't for the final Bowser battle, which seemed just very luck-based. I was literally about to just give up, and then I finally beat him. But other than that, really good challenge, and if you're really good at Paper Mario and want more of a challenge, I strongly recommend it. It's great. I also played Paper Mario Pro Mode, a hack that made it more challenging and added more content. That was a super fun stream series. Definitely would recommend checking that one out. And of course, there are Paper Mario randomizers. These are really long randomizers, but again, I love Paper Mario, so they're fun to play. Oh yeah, folks, you want to know a Let's Play that I've done that literally nobody knows about? I Let's Played Captain Toad Treasure Tracker. I did. Nobody knows it, but I don't think a single person has watched those videos, but I did. And that's okay. It's my most obscure Let's Play, and it's also probably my most boring Let's Play. I don't really remember anything about this, so yeah, you can skip that one. I played Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door later on. It's a great game, but honestly, I thought my Let's Play of it was only okay. I'm not the best player at Thousand Year Door. I can't do like the super guards out there, so honestly, you're probably better off watching somebody else. But hey, I still love this game. I also eventually streamed Super Mario Advance and finally beat it, but honestly, I really didn't enjoy it after the first world or two. It was a bit of a slog, but hey, I at least can say I beat it again. My Yoshi's Island stream was pretty fun, actually. I actually finally was able to beat it for the first time. I'd never beaten it before, and even though it came several years too late, I think I had a great time with it, and I got to actually play and beat every single level, including the secret levels and the extra levels, so that was great. I would actually recommend. I also 100% in Mario 64 for the first time on stream. I played the game a lot, but I'd never gotten all the stars. Yeah, that was a fun Let's Play, especially the part where my game just horribly glitched out and it looked like I was playing this Mario 64 Chaos Edition. Yeah, those are good times. I also played Mario Sunshine on stream recently, and I enjoyed that a lot more than I remember doing. Honestly, like, the game is better than I remember. It's still definitely the weakest of the 3D Mario games, but it was an enjoyable time. I had fun with it. I also played Mario Kart Wii CTGP, that hack that adds a huge amount of extra content to Mario Kart Wii. Yeah, that was really fun. I will be coming back to that eventually, but that's going to be kind of an on-again, off-again series. Another game series that I love to death, and might be my favorite series of all time now, and I've had a lot of Let's Plays of it, was Kingdom Hearts. Obviously, Kingdom Hearts is amazing. It's a great combination of Final Fantasy and Disney, and it's always just a fun time. And I played a lot of the games until now. I played Kingdom Hearts 1 back in my second year of Let's Play, and honestly, looking back, it was not a great Let's Play. Part of the reason is I played the original PlayStation 2 version instead of the Final Mix version, which is just generally a lot worse. The graphics are worse, there's unskippable cutscenes, a lot of the gameplay is a lot more clunky. Honestly, the only thing I like about the PlayStation 2 version is the fact that the Heartless colors were different than the original. I like those better. But honestly, my Kingdom Hearts 1 Let's Play was just not very great, and I got a lot of key information about the game just totally wrong, so yeah, this is one you can probably skip. I did the Kingdom Hearts 1 level 1 run, and that took ages. It literally took a whole year to get through it with all of the technical difficulties, but it was fun, albeit frustrating. You can check that one out. I also like playing the Kingdom Hearts 1 randomizer. I like it a lot more than I thought I would, so I'll probably go back to that someday. Chain of Memories, honestly, I love Chain of Memories. A lot of people don't, but I love Chain of Memories. My first Kingdom Hearts game, really enjoyed playing it, and honestly, I would like to go back to it. Well, I would say I'd like to go back to it. I was gonna say, maybe if they have a randomizer, but that's when I remember. Every playthrough of normal Chain of Memories is a randomizer, because the game is just kind of inherently random. Also, SUBMIT! Kingdom Hearts 2 I thought was a solid Let's Play. I had some decent jokes in there, and it was just solid gameplay, and I got to show off all the content, so that was fun. The Kingdom Hearts 2 randomizer, honestly, not as good as I thought it was going to be. Like, I definitely prefer the Kingdom Hearts 1 randomizer. The Kingdom Hearts 2 randomizer is just focused on combat, whereas the Kingdom Hearts 1 randomizer is more logic-based. Oh, also, one thing I've noticed is that I have to play the Kingdom Hearts 2 randomizer on Epic Games on my PC, and that crashes constantly. So, yeah, probably not going back to that unless I can get a more stable way of streaming it. I also streamed Free 5-8 over 2 days a while back. That was actually a fun stream series. It was cool interacting with the people who actually knew a little bit more about the game in there. And the post-game was honestly the best part, getting to play as the different characters, like, darn! One final group that I'll also lump together are, I like playing visual novels now. I've played a variety of visual novels on here, and my only issue with these is the fact that most of the visual novels I play are rated T or M. Now, one thing that I actually forgot to mention earlier is that I've always tried to be a family-friendly YouTube channel, within reason, obviously. Like, you'll notice, I really don't like swearing, I don't like talking about inappropriate fans, I think there's just better things to talk about and better ways to be funny. Obviously, there have been a lot of games that I've wanted to play because I've really liked them, but aren't entirely kid-appropriate. And I've eased up on this a lot lately, mainly because I don't think little children should be watching YouTube anyways. Having said that, if they are watching YouTube, and they do happen across my channel, I try to keep it kid-friendly, so anytime I play games that are rated T or M, I just make sure to actually put the logo of T or M in the thumbnail, as well as at the beginning of the video, and that's kind of been my way around it. Also, fun fact, this is something that only the true OGs will know, I actually have a separate channel called Arty Uncolored, which I originally made so I could play these T-rated contents or have content that wasn't exactly kid-friendly. I kind of regret making that, though. I've been debating actually just taking that channel down. I think the only videos I have on that channel are a single Crazy Taxi stream, and then some videos of me playing poker with some of the Lemmings forumers. Honestly, none of that's particularly great. I guess the Crazy Taxi stream's alright, but these days I just like having everything on one channel and just having that warning ahead of time. But anyways, now that we actually have got that covered, let's talk about the visual novels I played. First, Ace Attorney. Now, I've played four Ace Attorney games and more are down the way, and these are my favorite Let's Plays I've done, by far. These are my favorite Let's Plays to record and to edit and to share with people. And it makes me, honestly, a little bit sad that so few people have actually watched them. I don't want to be the guy who's just like, you need to watch these, watch my content, but doggone it. Please, if you have not yet and are even somewhat interested, please give the Ace Attorney series a try. They are hilarious Let's Plays that we've done. Marty and I are there the whole time, and they're just great. We do voice acting, we goof around a lot. It's great. So if you haven't checked them out already, this is really gonna be my only time of like, one of my only times of being like, no, please check it out. They're so good. And the main reason is because Marty and I recorded so many of these games already. Like, I've uploaded four of them. There are still three more Ace Attorney games that we fully recorded that I still need to edit and upload. And honestly, the reason we haven't done that yet is because I don't want to just be like, well, you're only getting Ace Attorney content from me for the next 3 years. I want to spread it out a little bit. And we're also planning on playing another one. So the Ace Attorney videos are not stopping anytime soon. So you're going to be seeing a lot more of these in the future. So I just recommend trying them out. See if they're for you. I love these games. They're amazing. I played them when I was young, and part of the great dichotomy of this is I've played the games before, Marty has not, so you kind of get the best of, like, I know what to do, Marty doesn't, so we don't really get stuck, but also we get, like, a great combination of, like, oh, I know what's happening, I know what's coming, so I can say some funny things as, like, foreshadowing, and also Marty has the blind reactions. It's, like, the best of both worlds. Now I'm going to delete the first two Phoenix Wright games that we played. These were kind of the first ones that we played with my Blue Yeti microphone, which is a way higher quality microphone than my headset. The problem is I didn't know how to use it properly, and our voices peak a lot in these videos. Still totally watchable, though. It just can be a little uncomfortable on the ears at times. And when we got to the third game, I had figured out how to use it properly. This is also the reason I don't use my Blue Yeti microphone for streams, is because they pick up everything. You can't just have the Blue Yeti be like, oh yeah, it'll filter out the background noise. No. I literally need to, like, record it, have a, like, 20-second period of silence so that I can have Audacity filter out the background noise. But in my streams, where I can't separate Audacity from the OBS game audio, you're basically going to get a huge amount of background noise if I use the Blue Yeti. Anyways, though, watch Ace Attorney. They're great. Hilarious videos, and more of them are coming. They're my favorite Let's Plays. Please give them a try. Okay, another visual novel I played was Clannad. Now, Clannad I decided to play because my sister was like, oh, it's on sale! And she had watched the anime. She's like, it's really good. So I decided to give it a try, and can I just say, one of my favorite games I've ever played, particularly on my channel, and this is by far my favorite game that I have streamed. And I feel bad saying you guys should check it out because this is also by far my longest series ever. It is 200 videos, and each video is around a half an hour, and some of those videos actually get closer to the 1 hour mark. So it is a big time commitment to watch it all because it's a huge game with so much content. But man, I gotta say, that is a game that I think back on a lot about how good it is. Like, it's so good. The characters are great, the story is great. It's full of, like, charming, funny, and genuinely emotional moments. Like, that game really actually got me to think a lot. It also has an amazing soundtrack, so definitely one of my favorite moments that I've had Let's Playing was playing Clannad. It's one that I look back on and I'm just like, man, I would love to get another game that could, another visual novel that could kind of hit me the same way. And that's part of the reason I've been playing other visual novels, and none of them have come to the same quality of Clannad, so man, it's so good though. If you could try it, you could try watching it. Again, it is a very long watch. You don't have to watch every route necessarily, but it's such a good game, and I think about it a lot. Okay, I also played The Fruit of Grisea, and I kind of regret this series. I wouldn't say I wish I had never played it, but this is a game. So the main reason I played Fruit of Grisea is actually because of a Doki Doki Literature Club mod that I'd seen called Fruits of the Literature Club, where it was kind of an homage to Fruit of Grisea, but in the Doki Doki Literature Club universe. And the main character in that was like a kind of like a spy vigilante, and he was like a no-nonsense, like kind of mean, but also like had a good heart kind of guy. He was kind of supposed to be an homage to the protagonist from Fruit of Grisea. And there was a lot of really cool and well-written action scenes in that, and I'm like, this is awesome! This is like great! Oh my gosh, it's based off of an actual visual novel. Yes, I want to play it. It's going to be cool. It's going to have so much action. It's going to be well written. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this visual novel has made me so uncomfortable. There are so many sexual jokes in it. There's so much stupidity in this. It actually physically hurt me to play it at certain times. And to this day, I absolutely refuse to do two of the girls' routes. I will not play Machina or Amine's route. You cannot make me. I did play the other free routes, and yeah, this was really uncomfortable to play. It had definitely had some funny moments, though, like the English lesson. That was really good. And Yumiko's route was definitely the best, despite her being a girl who literally was trying to murder us at the beginning. So, wow, character development. Also, Yuji is the worst protagonist. This is not up for discussion. Oh, and on the subject of Doki Doki Literature Club, I streamed that on Halloween a couple years ago, and that was the longest stream I ever did. I started at 8 p.m., and I don't think I finished until around 3 a.m., because I had to play the whole game. And honestly, that is a great game. See, that's an example of an M-rated game that's actually really good, because they don't make the sex jokes. Well, I mean, there is some somewhat vaguely sexual content in it, but it's not like... it's not to the same degree of, like, Fruit of Grisea by any means, and it's more just implied, like, weird stuff that happens. And it's intentionally designed to make you uncomfortable. That's part of it. Doki Doki Literature Club is a horror game, so they're trying to make you uncomfortable, whereas Fruit of Grisea is just like, wait, you're uncomfortable by this? What's wrong with you? Everybody's like this. Like, no, or not. That was a good game! You can check out the streams I did. I've broken them up. It's fun, and it's very spooky. Speaking of spooky, the last visual novel I played was the Higurashi When They Cry streams that I did for last Halloween. That's an awesome game! I would not put it at the same level as Clannad yet, but there are a lot more chapters, and I definitely want to play more. And one thing I thought about is, should I only play it during Halloween, or would people like to see me play more in other times of the year? Because I kind of want to get back to that, because it's really interesting. The characters are interesting, the theories that I have are interesting. It's just, yeah, it's going to be good. So those are kind of the main categories that I think back on. The rest are kind of just miscellaneous games that I want to talk about for a little bit. One Let's Play that I did that was really surprising to me was my Let's Play of Pikmin 3. Now, Pikmin 3 was one of those games I decided to Let's Play on a whim. I got it for my birthday at the same time I got the capture card, and I'm like, I've always wanted to play Pikmin 3. Why don't I record it? Why don't I do a blind recording of it? Yeah, it probably won't be great, but what's the harm? It actually turned into one of my most popular Let's Plays. I didn't really think much of it. Yeah, I had some funny reactions in it, like my reaction when Louis stole all of our juice and I wanted to stone him. That was pretty good. And I did end up getting 100%, but I didn't really think a whole lot of it. I'm just like, yeah, okay, like it was fine, but it actually got a lot of views, and I've had quite a few people comment on it and be like, dude, this is a great series, and like, I love it, I watch it every year. I'm just like, wow, I'm so... for all of you who talk about this, like, I'm really happy that you guys enjoyed this series, and I am very surprised that this is one of my more viewed ones. Particularly because I did Pikmin 2 No Deaths more recently, and this one is a much more impressive Let's Play series. This was super difficult! Pikmin 2 is a very difficult game, and going through it No Deaths is a suicide mission, but actually, I had a surprising amount of fun. I actually really like Pikmin 2, despite it being really unfair, and I don't know why. Possibly Stockholm Syndrome. I also played Frogger and Frogger 2 on my channel, two games from my childhood that I love a lot. And here's one thing I want to bring up. I've mentioned a couple of times throughout my videos that I consider Harvest Moon 64 to be kind of the first Let's Play I did that was good. And I generally am like, don't watch anything that I made before that. Well, that's not entirely true. When I think back, there are a couple of standouts. Frogger, He's Back is one of them. I actually think that this was a pretty good Let's Play of mine. It's a fairly obscure game, but enough people have seen it that they're like, oh yeah, I remember Frogger. And it's a fun game, it's relatively short, and my multiplayer video that I played with Marty was also really good, despite, again, having the shared headset issue. And it's one of my most viewed videos, too, so yeah, you can check it out. Frogger 2 took ages to actually get it to run, but when I actually did run it, it was another fun Let's Play. Although, I still like Frogger 1 more. Another weird Let's Play I did in my first year is the Let's Play of the Toy Story 2 action game, and I will defend this game with everything I've got. This game is good. It was from the era when 3D platformers were actually really big, and this one's actually very well made. And also, the soundtrack in this game is great, so I actually would recommend if you're like, Toy Story 2, I've never heard of that. You can check it out. Like, it's actually really good, and I truly enjoyed having I had a lot of fun with this one. So I look back on this one fondly. Definitely one of my better Let's Plays from my first year. Of course, Toy Story 2 wasn't the only Pixar game I played. Years later, I also played the Bugs Life action game. It's not a great game, but it is a fun one, and honestly, I have a lot of fondness for this game. Yeah, there's a lot of really frustrating parts, especially if you're getting 100%, but despite that, it's still a fun 3D platforming game. Also, the soundtrack in the Bugs Life action game is, like, stupidly good. Like, holy moly. Look up the Bugs Life PS1 soundtrack. Like, dear lord. The composer did not have to go this hard on a soundtrack from a licensed Bugs Life game, but I'm so glad they did. My last Let's Play that I started in my first year was Cave Story Plus. It's a Metroidvania-style game, and this is one I kind of wish I could do over again because I don't think the Let's Play was very good. I wasn't very good at the game, and my voice acting was pretty bad, so I wish I could kind of do it again, but alas, there we are. In my second year of Let's Playing, one of the games that I played almost immediately was my Undertale playthrough. Now, I'll be honest, I kind of forgot I played this one, which is interesting, because Undertale is a pretty well-known game. The only reason I actually played Undertale was because I was sick of seeing Undertale memes on Facebook constantly. Like, for pretty much the whole year after Undertale first came out, a couple of my friends were just constantly posting Undertale memes, and I knew vaguely what it was, but I'm just like, oh my gosh, seriously? Like, there's no way the game's that good. And what actually got me to play it was one of the Lemmings contest levels I played used Spider Dance music from Undertale as its level music, and I'm like, this is so good, and they're like, it's Undertale, it's got a great soundtrack. I'm like, alright, I'll give it a try. And honestly, this is an interesting Let's Play. The very beginning of the Let's Play, I tried to predict the story based on all the memes I had seen, and I got it like 80% accurate, which I'm kind of proud of, so that was fun. Undertale's a fun game. It's a funny game, so you have that. I think I had a couple issues with it, though. For one, this was another game that had bad audio, because this was a game that I actually used a new headset for, and that's when I learned that the new headset I had sucked. It was more expensive than the Logitech one I had, but it was way worse quality. So I actually never used it again, and that's why I still use my Logitech headset. Yeah, there are probably better quality ones out there, but I don't want to spend $100 on a headset only to find it's not better than my current one. And my current one's old reliable. We've went through a lot together, so I want to keep it. Also, when I streamed the Pacifist run, that got a little bit uncomfortable at times. Like, I was not super okay with the whole, like, oh, you're going on a practice date with Alpha so she can date Hyundai. I'm like, no, I'm not okay with this. But, well, you guys kind of knew that. I mean, you can look at my description, so. Okay, another game that I had forgotten about that I had Let's Played, but was actually, like, looking back, is one of my favorites. LEGO Star Wars! I totally forgot I Let's Played this, but this is a great Let's Play that Marty and I did. LEGO Star Wars is a fantastic game, and we played it together, and there was a lot of really entertaining moments, especially when we got to free run mode, and we're, like, kind of giving some of the weird characters backstories. So we're like, oh yeah, General Grievous' bodyguard is a pirate. Oh yeah, we could throw Jar Jar in the pit over and over again. No, that was a great game. Like, you should check it out. That was actually really fun. We also tried the Let's Play LEGO Star Wars 2. The problem was we couldn't finish it. This was in our abandoned Let's Play highlights because we wanted to play for the whole game, but the game glitched up when we got to the Sarlacc pit and we could not beat the level. The game literally refused to let us beat the level because it kept forcing the AI characters that we needed off a cliff over and over again. Which is a shame! I really wanted to finish that Let's Play! That was a good Let's Play! At least we still got the best moments as highlights and put those on my channel, but man, I really wish we could have gotten the full 100% Let's Play of that. It would have been great. My final Star Wars game that I played was Episode 1 Pod Racing. I played for the whole game on stream. It was fun. We also played Animal Crossing. Kind of on the subject of abandoned Let's Play highlights, Marty and I originally planned on a full Let's Play of the original GameCube Animal Crossing, and obviously we didn't complete that, but we did record 6 episodes of it and uploaded the highlights, and I think that really just kind of, I think that was enough, you know? We had a fun time in Bowtopia, there was a lot of funny parts, so I would encourage you guys to check it out, there was a lot of really amusing parts for that. But beyond that, I also streamed New Horizons in the last year, and those were really fun streams. They were very fun, very chill streams, and those are also great streams for me to play, like, maybe after Backyard Baseball. So if Backyard Baseball ends early, maybe I'll just play New Horizons afterwards. I think that could be great, because I had a really fun time visiting my island for the first time in, like, years, and just seeing what everything is up. That was great. I would want to play that again. Okay, probably my most unique Let's Play I did was my Let's Play of Fire Emblem Game Boy Advance co-op with my older brother Link. Now, the idea of co-op was basically we each got a certain amount of units. Basically, anytime we got a new unit, it would alternate between whether I or he got the new unit. So we kind of shared units and we're working together to complete the objective, but also kind of competing with each other to be like, I want to get the kill to get the experience points. We tried to divide stuff up, but it was a really cool idea. The problem was, well, there were a couple of problems. For one, the audio was not great. We again had to share the headset, and my brother was not good at talking into it, so you could barely hear him, so that was a bit of a problem. There was also just a lot of weird moments. My brother doesn't really like talking about the game, and he just wants to talk about totally random stuff, which I'm like, there's a time and a place for that, but I don't want to just be like, oh yeah, let's just spend the entire episode talking about Star Wars Episode 5, even though it has nothing to do with what's going on here. So that was interesting. And also, one of the videos that we recorded, all the footage corrupted, and so we had our commentary, but not the footage. And if you know anything about Fire Emblem, you literally can't redo the level footage and expect it to line up, because every time you play Fire Emblem, it's going to be a little bit different. Even if you restart the chapter that you were on, the amount of experience you get might be different, like your level ups will be different, like whether you hit or crit is going to be different, like you cannot possibly make it all line up. So I actually had to make a very crude animated sketch kind of summarizing the highlights of what happened. So I guess that was kind of a highlight, but yeah, I don't know, this is kind of a failure. The audio quality was just too bad. I also played Fire Emblem Game Boy Advance in a couple of other times. I tried streaming the hardest difficulty of that, but I failed epically every single time. But I might want to return to that in the future. Eventually, I want to beat it. I also have played Fire Emblem Game Boy Advance randomizers, but those are very different, and they're the longest randomizers by far. They take, like, 4 weeks to beat in terms of streams, so that's a long time. And honestly, it's just not as fun as the other randomizers, so I don't really return to those very often. I also played Fire Emblem 6 from Japan for the first time. It was fun, but it was also very annoying because it had a lot of fake difficulty in it. Oh man, I am glad I finished, but I probably am not going to go back to it, and I don't think its design is particularly great. I prefer the other Fire Emblem game. Okay, folks. We've now arrived at probably one of the biggest turning points of me Let's Play-wise, Harvest Moon 64. Now, I have mentioned this one a lot, and I truly believe this is kind of the linchpin for me in so many ways. And here's why. For one, this is the last Let's Play that I made while using Windows Movie Maker as my video editing software. So, for those of you who don't know, up to that point, and including this point, I used it also for Harvest Moon 64, I used Windows Movie Maker on Windows 8. Now, if you don't know anything about Windows Movie Maker, you know that that's basically asking for it. Windows Movie Maker is extremely primitive and ridiculously limited and terribly made. It crashed constantly while editing it. It didn't let you save things partway through, so you couldn't just like, I'm gonna save this and come back to it later. You had to finish the editing all in one go, so if it crashed on you, that's all of the work undone. It also could crash while rendering, and up to this point, I really hadn't had a problem with it, because up to Harvest Moon 64, I really didn't put any time into editing my videos at all. I just kind of made sure that the Audacity commentary lined up with the game audio, and then just kind of shipped it out, and that's it. But Harvest Moon 64 was the first Let's Play I did that kind of forced me to actually put a lot of time into editing, because this game is very monotonous. most of this game is just doing the same thing over and over again, and I didn't want to show that to people. So I actually cut a huge amount of the footage out and spliced it together so that I kept only the interesting parts. While this is great for the viewer, doing this in Windows Movie Maker was absolute torture. It literally convinced me to push in like $100 or so on better video editing software back when I was a poor college student. That should tell you how bad Windows Movie Maker was. But honestly, the reason why I think this was a turning point wasn't just because I changed editing software, but also this is just where I really started to have a lot more polish in my Let's Plays. Like I said, I actually put a lot of time into editing this series of cutting out unimportant parts, as well as editing in special effects, like say the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire music when I found the guy named who looked like Regis Philbin, or even just something simple like this is my first Let's Play I did where I had the end screen included. It was just a big turning point for me. This was definitely my highest quality Let's Play up to this point, and it's one that I actually look back on and have a lot of pride in. I think that this Let's Play turned out pretty much as best as it possibly could, with one big exception. Something I constantly want to forget about, but every time I have to remember it. When I Let's Play Harvest Moon 64, I set out to have the perfect game, get the best possible evaluation at the end, and get all of the photos in the photo album, which are basically the main collectibles of the game. Well, as it turns out, I didn't succeed. I got almost the perfect evaluation, but the stupid shipper guy is like, you didn't ship enough stuff, even though I shipped more than the entire gross domestic product of several countries in the real life world, he still wasn't satisfied. Apparently you have to ship like 10,000 things in the game, and I'm just like, are you kidding me? It's so boring, I didn't want to do that. But the thing that really annoyed me was the fact that I didn't get the last photo in the game for the party photo, and I don't really blame myself for that, because as it turns out, I used a walkthrough to figure out the criteria for the party photo, and as it turns out, the community didn't even know what the criteria to get the photo even was until a couple years ago, after I finished the Let's Play. And apparently there's an entire in-game mechanic called happiness that nobody knew about until pretty recently that plays a key role in that. So yeah, I literally just didn't have a chance of getting that. It really annoyed me at the time because I literally set out to do the whole Let's Play because I wanted that freaking photo and I didn't get it. But you know what? I still look back on that Let's Play and I'm proud of what I did. I think it's a really great watch if you haven't seen it. I highly recommend it. I think it's one of my best Let's Plays and definitely a turning point for me. And even though I technically didn't get the best ending, I still consider that I did, because honestly, the only things I didn't do were A, something that was really, really boring that I didn't even know about, and B, I didn't ship apparently as much enough stuff. I could have, but I intentionally didn't ship a bunch of crops because it was just so freaking boring. Alright, I also Let's Play Sonic Adventure 2 Battle and did some additional streams of that to get some extra emblems. I mean, I like Sonic Adventure 2 Battle, but honestly, playing this again made me realize how dated it was that I don't like it as much as I used to. Having said that, the Child Garden is still top tier. I also played DuckTales Remastered for the Wii U. That was a fun Let's Play. I loved me some Scrooge, and it was a fun platforming game. Secret of Monkey Island was another Let's Play I did. It was very funny, but mainly just because the game is funny, not because I was funny. I was basically a non-issue in this Let's Play. I'd like to play Monkey Island 2 at some point, but maybe in the future. Alright, another one of my most viewed Let's Plays and one of my most famous Let's Plays is The Logical Journey of the Zumbinis, and I think this is one of my most popular Let's Plays for a variety of reasons. For one, much like the Humongous Entertainment games, it's also the perfect mix of it's niche enough that pretty much nobody has played it before, but also popular enough that everybody knows what it is. And another reason why Zumbinis was such a popular Let's Play is because this might have been the hardest game to get running. Zumbinis is a game that is notoriously pretty much impossible to get to run on modern machines, very similar to Lemmings Revolution. But whereas Lemmings Revolution at least had several patches people had made to help it work on modern machines, Zumbinis, you're just out of luck. You basically have to emulate an older version of Windows or you cannot run the game. Which means that basically nobody had Let's Played it. So when I finally got Windows XP emulating on my computer, I was able to play it, and all of a sudden people are like, wait, somebody played Zumbinis! I remember that game! Let's watch it! And honestly, this is a great Let's Play of mine as well. I'm very proud of it. This is another one of those Let's Plays I put the most effort into making high quality. I had specific strategies detailed for every single puzzle that's listed in the entire game, at least as far as the ones that could be solved. And heck, I even made Python scripts and put them on GitHub to help people solve some of the puzzles. Like, I went all out with this one, so I'm glad people appreciate it. I've even had speedrunners of Zumbinis be like, dude, your strategies have helped me solve these quickly, thank you. So yeah, people really like Zumbinis, and I definitely think it's one of my better Let's Plays in terms of quality, so I'm really happy at how that turned out. Has anyone heard of Rocket Slime? That was an obscure DS game that is absolutely amazing. More people need to be aware of it. I love it, and I Let's Played it. It was great. Oh man, Marty and I played Kirby Air Ride, and that was another Let's Play I look back on really fondly. We had some great banter, it's a super fun game, one of my favorite games even though it's admittedly very dated, and yeah, like, we got everything in this game. There's so much content to the game, but we got everything. Definitely would recommend if you think you're interested in this. Oh yeah, I also played A Bird Story. I totally forgot about this, it's only 3 videos long, and I honestly don't remember anything that happened in this game. But I had it on Steam, and I'm like, you know, whatever. My Chibi-Robo Let's Play is another great one. Chibi-Robo is a very hidden gem for the GameCube, and at this point, more people are aware of it. But it's very hard to get, because, boy, howdy, are these games expensive. I'm so glad I still had my copy from it being a kid. And yeah, this is an amazing game. If you have no idea what it is, you basically play as a cleaning robot, and you clean up the house. And it sounds terrible, but it's actually great. Especially because, like... Yeah, you're basically a cleaning robot, but there's also like a big family drama that's happening. The dad's out of work, the mom is trying to struggle with the bills, the little girl who you got you as a birthday gift thinks she's a frog. All the toys come to life at night like it's Toy Story. It's actually really good. Like, it's so good. The story is great, the characters are so funny. I strongly recommend it. I also played Banjo-Kazooie and Banjo-Tooie. Both amazing games. I don't think my Let's Plays on them were particularly fantastic. They were just kind of meh and informative. But hey, I had a lot of fun playing them. Oh yeah, Reader Rabbit's Math Journey. This is a fun one. I love playing these classic old PC edutainment games that like enough people have kind of heard of that they're, I remember this, but also nobody's played them before. They're great. They're great nostalgia hits for me and for other people. So yeah, I think this one turned out great. I would be interested in playing more Reader Rabbit games in the future if I can get a hold of them. Okay, Ghost Trick Phantom Detective, watch this. Watch this Let's Play. It's an amazing game, amazing story. Marty and I did amazing voice acting, and we had amazing reactions to stuff. Also amazing music. Just trust me, watch this. This game is truly amazing, and it's only like 18 videos long, so it's great. I've also done Roller Coaster Tycoon streams. I love doing these streams. The problem is I need to find themes for the theme parks before I actually start streaming, but these are fun. I love playing Roller Coaster Tycoon and streaming them, even if it takes a while to edit the videos. Speaking of streams, I streamed Hollow Knight last year. Yeah, that was an amazing game, don't get me wrong. It was lots of fun, but honestly, my big issue is that it was just way bigger than I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be Cuphead length, and it turned out to be like Skyrim length. Like, geez Louise, if I had known it was going to be that long, I would have broken it up. I thought it was just going to be like a 10-hour game, maybe, or like a 5-hour game, not like a 70-hour game. But hey, it was still amazing, still really high quality, but there were some ragey parts as well. Plants vs. Zombies was a fun game. I loved it. I loved Let's Playing it, but honestly, the Let's Play was kind of meh. Not a whole lot of entertaining stuff happened. It's a tower defense game. Honestly, probably the best part of my Let's Play was when I got to play the remixes people made of the music during the sped up part sections when I was just playing the game normally. Okay, Piglet's Big Game. Terrible game, but it made for an amazing Let's Play. Seriously, Marty and I, we had a lot of fun with this one. It's a great spoopy game. It's hilarious. You should give it a try. All right, now I want to go over some of the weird one-off streams that I've done now and again. My first couple of streams on my miscellaneous streams playlists were back when I actually played Splatoon. I actually streamed Splatoon twice, and in one of those streams, I literally didn't realize I wasn't recording my voice during it. I don't play Splatoon anymore. I was super into Splatoon 1 on the Wii U. It was great, super fun. I got kind of into Splatoon 2, but not really, and I have no plans of getting Splatoon 3. It's just, I guess, not really my kind of game anymore. My sister loves it, though. Another game that I streamed a couple of times was Sid Meier's Civilization 4. This was a fun couple of streams that I did. Basically, back in the day, I was really into Civ 4, especially when I was in college, so I had a fun time streaming that a few times, and I tried to go for a different victory every single time I played. I never really have had a desire to go back to it because I'm just not as into it anymore, especially since there's, like, you know, two other Civilization games that have come out since then. And yeah, I've just never really wanted to go back. I definitely enjoyed streaming Civ 4 the few times that I actually did do it. I just don't think I really have anything more to do going back there. I mean, yeah, I didn't get every possible victory, but I did the victories that I liked doing. I played as the civilizations I liked playing as, and honestly, I'm probably not going back to this. I did actually end up playing Civilization 5 on Iho Tolat's channel once, so that was kind of fun. But Civilization is one of those games that's kind of a big time sink to play, and I'm not really looking for any more time sinks in my life. I love Cuphead. Cuphead's one of my favorite games of all time. Easily my favorite modern game of all time. And yeah, I've loved speedrunning it, and I love playing for the DLC. It's super hard, but very rewarding. Last year, I also streamed Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego? I really like this stream series. Carmen Sandiego is a classic game from my childhood. And again, another one of those, like, old-timey edutainment games that a lot of people know about, but not a whole lot of people have actually played on YouTube or Twitch or anything like that. So it was cool getting people along for the ride, and even people who've never heard of it before kind of getting into it as well. And one of the things that I really liked about this stream series was that it was short. This was a series that I did at the same time as Backyard Baseball. I like keeping my weekday streams at around an hour and a half in length, and Backyard Baseball, each game does not take an hour and a half, so I kind of have to fill up some extra time. This is where I really like finding short games that I can stream, and I'm always looking for games that I can stream kind of in tandem with Backyard Baseball, and this was a perfect game to do that for. Because I think an hour and a half of just Carmen Sandiego would get pretty boring, but if it was just like a half an hour or like 20 minutes of Carmen Sandiego, that was like the perfect bite-size amount. And I had a lot of fun playing this. It was great. I played Baldi's Basics as a Halloween stream. That was a fane. I also played Five Nights at Freddy's on stream for Halloween last year as well. And I was impressed. I was able to literally beat it 100% in a single stream. Like, I pat myself on the back for that one. There were also a couple of ongoing multiplayer series that I've done. Ultimate Chicken Horse, probably my favorite reoccurring multiplayer series that I've done. I freaking love this game and the multiplayer. The only issue I have is getting enough people who actually want to participate, as you generally need at least 3 players in order to have some entertaining rounds. You can technically do just 2 players, but it's nowhere near as good, because again, I like having more people to play off of, but this is also a very fun time. I also have played Among Us. I played Among Us a couple of times back when it was like the big fad of 2020 and 2021. But honestly, I probably won't be making any more Among Us videos. I just don't enjoy the game as much. There's very few people who are actually interested in it. And honestly, a lot of the groups that I've actually played with, I probably won't play with again. I don't like being unfairly targeted in this game. It makes it impossible for me to have fun. As far as some one-off Let's Plays that I've done, there have been a couple fun ones. One of my most obscure videos is my Let's Play of Katamari Damacy with my older brother Link. We did one video of it. Nobody watched it, but I mean, it was fine. Marty and I played Sesame Street Art Workshop as well. This is a fun one. I mean, the microphone peaked way too much because of how much we were laughing, because again, this was before I knew how to use my Blue Yeti microphone properly, but it was still super funny! You get to put Sesame Street stickers on backgrounds, and it's hilarious. It's as much fun as you make it, and we made it very fun. We also played through 2 of the Arthur Living Books games, Arthur's Reading Race and Arthur's Computer Adventure. Both great videos. My favorite part of Arthur's Reading Race was us playing the demos for the other Living Books games, like Bernstein Bears in the Dark. That was good times. I've also loved doing April Fool's Let's Plays. Every April Fool's, I play a game that I would never play normally, but still kind of enjoy. My very first April Fool's video is, surprise, surprise, one of my most viewed videos of all time, Winnie the Pooh's Preschool, which I titled Hardest Game Ever Made, Winnie the Pooh Preschool. Originally, I'll be honest, I was just intending on playing preschool and just uploading and be like, yeah, it's April Fool's, I'm playing a preschool game. I decided to take it a step further on a whim and be like, this game is super hard, it's insanely difficult to beat, and pretended that this preschool game was actually super difficult. And surprise, surprise, I learned clickbait works, and it was my first video to get to 1K views, and I'm just like, really? up to this point, it's still in my top 5 most viewed videos, but thankfully it has been surpassed by at least a couple of other fans. But of course, the fans that have surpassed it, I also don't think should be the videos that have, but more on that later. Seriously, my top viewed video is my first backyard baseball stream. Now, I mentioned my backyard baseball streams are fun, but the first one that I did was the worst one by far. It was not tied to any season. Stop watching that one! Watch literally any other backyard baseball stream. Not that one! It's probably because I titled it Baseball at Its Best. I meant the game was the best, not this game was the best, but... hey, hey. There's even a dramatic cut that cuts out a huge amount of the footage. Why do people watch this? Stop it! Honestly, my only real regret with Poop Preschool is the fact that I could just remove the black border around the video. Like, I couldn't get it to record, I couldn't get it to play in any bigger size, and back then I didn't know how to crop stuff out. Again, this was back before I knew how to video edit, and I was still using Windows Movie Maker, which probably can't crop stuff anyways, so it's just stuck there. And YouTube's built-in video editor is complete garbage, so it's just stuck there. It's just this ugly black border around a tiny screen. It's terrible. Second year, I wanted to play like 20 different games, but I kid you not, like all of them failed. Like literally, Marty and I tried 20 games to record for an April Fool's game. None of them worked. So we had to play Mario Strikers with all max unlimited power-ups. All power-ups were Bob-ombs, and I just played it in a really casual Bob Ross-esque voice. It was okay, but disappointing compared to what I wanted to do. Our third of April Fool's Let's Play was Candyland Adventure. Now, this one was an amazing video. If you haven't seen it, it's worth every minute. It's a hilarious video. And then this last year we did Let's Make a Word, another really funny video, if you couldn't tell by the sheer number of highlights we got from it in the 2022 highlights video. I did some multiplayer one-offs as well. Marty and I played Sonic Riders a while back. Sonic Riders is a fun racing game, definitely not Mario Kart, but the heavy bike is just kind of OP, so that just kind of won every time. I also played Battlefront 2 multiplayer with Marty and then with Link. It would have been great, but again, really bad audio quality because of the stupid headset sharing. I wish I could do it again, but I can't play Battlefront 2 anymore. I don't have a PS2 or Battlefront 2, so whoops. I also totally forgot that Marty, Link, and I recorded a video of us playing Smash 4 together. Obviously, it's really dated now, but that happened. Oh, we also played Monsters, Inc. Dodgeball, Monsters, Inc. Scream Arena. I think we're the only people who have done multiplayer in this, and it was really obscure, but we had fun with it, so that's funny. Marty and I also played Pac-Man World Rally, all of the rounds in it, and that's another one of my most popular videos. I don't really know why, but I love the game, so I mean, hey, there we go. And then, there are some other videos that we can talk about. Obviously, I make highlights for my stream playlists. Those are fun. Obviously, the bar has risen a lot. Back in the day, I would make Twitch highlights over anything remotely funny, but now, obviously, the bar is pretty high, and most of them come from backyard baseball. And I also make, just at this point, kind of yearly highlights videos of the best of my videos. I actually did a highlights video back on my first year of Let's Playing in 2016, but I have since made those videos unavailable. I still have them uploaded, but they're privated. Mainly because my first year of Let's Playing didn't really have any highlights. I thought they did, but no. All of the highlights put in, I'm just like, this isn't funny. This isn't a highlight. Why did you put this in, Past Arty? This is terrible. So yeah, I've made those unavailable. Obviously, the new highlights videos I really enjoy, but man, they take months to put together. Even my new video editing software has a hard time getting all of them together, because you gotta have 200 different video sources, and you've gotta put them together, and even my new software, Vegas Pro, does not like that, and I even had to upgrade from Pro 14 to Pro 20 this year, just to get that 2022 highlights video made, so I really hope we can continue doing that, but it's a lot of work. I occasionally have made music remixes. Those are fun to do, but obviously I can't really compose music. I can just take existing music and combine it together, so options to do that are pretty limited, but when I can do it, it's fun. I did one tier list video on my 25th birthday of ranking the Disney villains, and that's now my number 2 most viewed YouTube video, because of course it is! Of course, the tier list video that I don't really care about made it really high up, but whatever. I mean, I had fun with that. Took a long time, but I had fun with it, and I'm glad people enjoy it, and it's actually prompted a lot of discussion of, who is the most evil Disney villain? I mean, I might do more tier-less videos in the future, but it's just, I feel like that's the lazy way. I don't know, I like playing games more than that anyways. I have also done a couple meme videos, like the What I Think All Anime Is Like, which was just me ripping a scene from Horton Hears a Who. And I also did the R for All Imagine Spots video for season one. That was fun. Want to do it for more? I've been trying to do it for season two. I can't find all of the season two episodes. I can find most of them on kisscartoons.com, but it doesn't have all of them. Specifically, I can't find Arthur's underwear anywhere, and I know there are dream sequences in that, so if I can't find a way to watch Arthur's underwear and record it, I can't make that video, folks. And until I find a way, we're not getting it. Sorry. And then finally, I want to talk about some of the lost footage. See, for those of you who have been around the block for a long time might realize there are a couple of things I have done that I have never uploaded, and they are now lost forever, specifically with regards to streams. And there are a couple of them. So first off, there are a couple of Lemmings streams that I did that I don't think I ever ported over to YouTube back when I did them on Twitch. Whatever, it's not a huge loss, but I don't think anybody really cares about those. There are two other streams, though, that I've actually streamed more recently that there is evidence of, but you can't actually find the real thing. One of them is I actually streamed Mega Man 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 all together in one stream. It was a really long stream, and I didn't like how it turned out. I got very ragey towards the end, and it just wasn't great, so I just never bothered uploading it because I'm like, yeah, I don't want this. The other one that you may have noticed is I have a Twitch highlight from a Redwall game, but I don't actually have the stream where it came from uploaded. Yeah. So that's how I learned the hard way that Twitch doesn't archive your streams for more than a week or two. Because I had originally planned on streaming to Twitch and then being like, okay, then I'll download the stream. Because back then I didn't stream and record. I was stupid. So I'm like, yeah, I'll put it to Twitch and then I'll download it and upload it. And then I put it off for too long, then I couldn't download it. I'm just like, well, it's gone forever now. I still had the Twitch highlight because I made that right afterwards, but the actual stream that I did of Redwall the Scout is lost forever, which is a shame. I actually want to go back and play the whole game because I love Redwall and there was a lot of cool stuff in that, but for some reason I could run the Redwall game on my old computer, which was terrible, but on my new computer that's way higher quality, I can't run it. Like, the game is too high quality for my game. It literally just runs at a snail's pace. It's unplayable. Just a shame. I love Redwall. I want to support it, but I can't record it more. Well, I only did one stream of it, so and the funniest part I got by far was the stream highlight, so that's really all you need to see, but I'd like to go back someday, but I can't. Ah, well. That's kind of it for the lost streams. There have been a couple of Let's Plays that I've recorded, but this never uploaded, and I'm not going to upload. Maybe I'll try them again in the future, but I'll save that for another time. So That's a lot of stuff to cover, but I think now I'm ready to close out the video. So once again, I want to thank you all very much for 1,000 subscribers. Honestly, again, the main reason I made it this retrospective is because I wanted this to be a big celebration of my whole channel. And realistically, I don't see us making it to a bigger milestone than 1,000 subs. Like, we'll probably get to 2,000, maybe 3,000, maybe 4,000, heck, maybe even 5,000 subs. But the next big milestone for me would be 10,000. I don't see me getting 10,000. I do not see me getting 10,000. If I do, then I'm in trouble. So, in the meantime, like, again, 1,000 is just that nice big number. It's a big milestone. 2,000, not much bigger. Like, it's like, oh, it's 2,000. Okay, yeah, whatever. 5,000 is a bit bigger, but, like, 10,000 is kind of that next nice big round number that to aim for. So I'm having kind of mini goals, as you've probably seen. If I hit 2,000 subscribers, I have agreed to actually give anime a try, and I will try to record my reactions to it. Well, my audio reactions to it. I still never intend on revealing my face to people, at least not on this channel. I have contemplated for a while having a completely different channel where I actually do show my face and do much more serious videos of, like, Bible studies or a lot of stuff, because it's no surprise, I am a Christian, and I would love to be able to talk about the Bible and actually share real wisdom instead of just being like, I'm playing baseball. But that's something that I've thought about for a while now. I still haven't actually gotten around to doing it. I think there's a lot of stuff I need to clean up in my life first before I go about trying to teach people about that, but that's just something that I've thought about. I do intend on continuing making Let's Plays and streams for the time being. This will probably not be a lifelong thing, though. My life will be changing this year, probably a lot. I'm trying to get a new job. Probably we'll be moving to a new state, and we'll actually just start trying to pursue other things in real life that I want. So, I'm not saying that anything's gonna stop. No, like I said, I still have 3 Ace Attorney Let's Plays I need to upload over the span of the next couple of years, and I still have a couple Let's Plays I want to do, and a lot of streams I want to do, but it just might be taking a back seat in the near future. That's all I'm saying. I'll let you guys know more on that if it comes, but at the very least, I like doing things the way that I'm doing now. Obviously, I've been moving back a little bit since, I don't know, compare myself to a couple years ago when I was uploading way more frequently. Now I have a very regular schedule. So, yeah. I've gradually been moving back away from this. It's not that I don't enjoy it, it's just, again, I don't want to live with regrets. I don't want to be 40 years old and look back and be like, I've sacrificed so much of my life to do Let's Playing and I regret it. I don't want to end up that way. I don't want to sacrifice other parts of my life to this. So now that I'm 26, I'm not getting any younger. I kind of got to get my rear in gear if I want to get my life in order. So just, yeah, that's what I wanted to share with you guys. All right. I can't think of anything else to say, but thank you. Again, thank you very much. I really, truly appreciate each and every one of you. And I also want to point out, folks, I do have a Discord server. If you are interested in joining, that is linked in my YouTube About page. We're always happy to have new people, and I always love talking to people in there, getting to know people a little bit better, and actually interacting with people, because, you know, I don't want to think of people as just fans. If you actually interact with me, you can actually become a bit more of a pal. So, yeah. If you want to join the Discord, you are welcome to. Otherwise, thanks for watching, everybody. I'll be continuing my videos and streams in the future. This took a long time to put together, but I hope the overall product was enjoyable for you all. Anyways, I hope you have a very fantastic rest of your day, and God bless, everybody.